Listen to us online at thenewwsjs.com. Listen to us on your smartphone at wsjs.com. Listen to us wherever and whenever you want at wsjs.com. Like when your Uncle Phil starts showing his vacation slides from 1964.
Now, these slides here are when we went on our trip to the Grand Canyon.
Anyway, you can always slide over and hang out with us at WSJS.com, your online home for news, talk, and sports.
Now, local businesses can get closer to every customer in their city with fast, affordable shipping. Introducing USPS Connect Local. You want speed? We deliver same or next day. You want savings? We give you supplies at a flat rate. You want less legwork? We do free pickups. Move your local business forward with the United States Postal Service. Let's connect at uspsconnect.com/local. Specific markets, restrictions apply. Same day or next day delivery expected, but not guaranteed.
We are news, talk, sports for the triad. WSJS Winston-Salem, Greensboro, High Point, Burlington. Online at wsjs.com. Yes, Josh Crabb has opinions.
There is nothing that entertains the audience and the masses more than me being bothered.
And yes, he's got attitude.
Really, none of the game made sense to me.
And that's exactly why you love him.
When this all gets sorted out, I think you and me should get an apartment together.
You're on The Drive with Josh Crabb.
We've made it to a Friday drive. It is WSJS, News Talk Sports for the Triad, where it is Triad Golf going to be on display today with Friday at the Masters for all to see. We'll have updates on what's happening at Augusta all throughout the show, but the Triad Golf piece, longtime Wake Forest golf coach Jerry Haas joins us about a half hour from now. However, far away from Augusta, but very close to us, there is a lot happening in college basketball. Earlier today, both Kyle Filipowski and Jared McCain announced they have declared for the NBA draft. That much was expected. Last night, however, Duke learned Tyrese Proctor will return for a third season in Durham, surprising many in the process by doing so. And that is a massive, massive win for the Blue Devils. With respect to Jeremy Roach, they'd much rather have Proctor back than Jeremy. Some scouts told me throughout the season, Tyrese Proctor has a higher NBA ceiling than anybody else on this Duke team, including McCain and Filipowski. He's a terrific defender. He might be the best perimeter defender in the ACC next year. He has an NBA body. That much is only going to get better going into his third year in college basketball. Proctor's decision does lessen Roach's chances of returning, you would think. Caleb Foster, you imagine, is coming back with the injury he sustained. Not going to be a high draft pick, you want to think. So he can come back playing on a Duke team that's supposed to be incredibly good. And you have now Proctor in the backcourt too. Not a lot of room for Jeremy. Not a lot of room. And Duke needs the roster space. John Shire, he's having difficult conversations right now, it seems like. That might explain Mark Mitchell going into the portal this week. Plus, Christian Reeves, right after the season ended. Probably Jaden Shute, we'll see. Then we got the announcements from Flip and Jared McCain. No surprise on either of them, but this was a really nice sentiment from Jared McCain in his announcement on social media.
Even only being here for 1 year, I got to see the impact and the power of the brotherhood, and that's what made this decision extremely hard. But I've always been a dream chaser. I've always been wanting to reach my goals, and that next one is the NBA. So with that being said, I will be entering my name in the 2024 NBA draft. I'm blessed and honored to be a part of the brotherhood, and I will be a Blue Devil for life.
The magic number in college basketball is 13. That's how many scholarships you get. So going through Duke, everybody knows about Cooper Flagg coming in, and you might know about North Carolina native Isaiah Evans from Charlotte and Malawak, this Senegal top five center that's coming in that's over 7 feet tall. That's just half of the freshman recruiting class. They've got six coming in altogether, so that takes up about half your roster space. You have Proctor returning, Foster returning, Stewart. That puts us at nine. Then you have Jaden Schutt, who still has not entered the portal yet, but many expect that he's going to. Jalen Blakes, TJ Power, and Jeremy Roach. When you add that together, guess where that gets us? 13. So John Chire, who didn't add a transfer last year, right now does not have roster space to add somebody if he wants to. That's why difficult conversations might need to happen with Jeremy Roach or with Jaden Schutt. Because if you do open up a roster spot, there is a starting position available for Duke. Sean Stewart's a guy that you could plug in and go with a big lineup and Cooper Flagg playing at the three, but more than likely is your first guy off the bench rotating with Malawak. Isaiah Evans is a top 15 recruit as a five-star, but everybody would kind of understand it if you're playing for the number one team in the country, presumed number one team in the country, coming off the bench as a freshman if you're not a top 10 recruit. That's a guy you have in your rotation. You don't expect either TJ Power or Jalen Blakes to be starting for you. So there is that spot alongside Malawag, Cooper Flagg, Tyrese Proctor, Caleb Foster, assuming that Foster is returning again, that you could add an incredible player through the portal. Think about it. Would there be a more coveted position, a more coveted destination in America than being the fifth starter on this Duke team? You get the NIL that comes along with being at Duke. You have 8 to 10 NBA scouts watching every single game Duke plays because of those other two guys. So the exposure of that will lift you up. And the team's supposed to be amazing as a result. Like, John Chire, if he has that roster spot and that starting spot, will have the best pitch in America to a recruit that any recruit across the country would be crazy to turn down. And what you could do with it, John L. Davis, who led FAU to a Final Four a couple of seasons ago, he entered the portal after this season. He has 1 year left. Why not him? That'd be pretty exciting. Wisconsin has a small forward that seems like would go perfectly into that spot. His name's AJ Storr, that maybe he could be your small forward as a double-digit scorer on average. Just the flexibility of it. The last time Duke had a top-flight transfer come in and start for them, not counting guys like Ryan Young, who had some spot starts, and Jacob Grandison the same way from Illinois, you probably have to go back a decade ago to Rodney Hood from Mississippi State. Find the last time that happened. But the return of Tyrese Proctor, that is a massive, massive deal for the Blue Devils. We are streaming video on YouTube, Twitch, on X. You can chime in on the show on our YouTube comments. We have our replies open on Twitter at WSJS Radio. Will Dalton, the executive producer of this show, is facilitating it all, taking your calls at 336-777-1600. Let's get into today's Masters.
Yes, let's get into that.
I was literally about to get into it. Literally. Just about. Do your thing.
Bryson DeChambeau, Scottie Scheffler tied right now for the lead in this thing, 7 under par.
Yeah.
Saw Bryson DeChambeau in the practice area earlier today just whacking balls.
Bryson just birdie one to get to 7 under, and
he's through Scheffler, nine.
Yeah. He is through nine.
Scheffler's through two. Then you got Max Homa at 6 under par. Nikolai Højgaard. Nailed at it. 5 under, Danny Willett 5 under as well.
Hodgkard just bogeyed. Is it 4?
And Ryan Fox at 4 under.
Thank you.
That's the latest out at the Masters.
One name you didn't mention there, Tiger Woods. Even though Tiger's chances of winning a green jacket again is slim, he's already won today. Barring a collapse on his final three holes. Let me add that disclaimer. Hopefully we don't see that from Tiger. He's at 2 over on 15. The cut line is projected to be at 4 over par, meaning Tiger is likely to make it to the weekend. that would be a win because that will be the record for consecutive Masters cuts made at 24 straight. That's a record that's never going to be broken. Some say that Jack Nicklaus is 18. That's a record that's never going to be broken. Nah, this is more difficult to break because it requires such consistency, and Tiger's career is going to be defined by consistency. The greatest record he has among the many that he set, 142 straight cuts made on the PGA Tour. How long is that? That's him going from 1998 to 2005, 7 years without missing a cut, without having a weekend where you're just off and you're not contending on the weekend. That's crazy. To put a perspective how crazy that is, second place historically is 113, about 30 off of what Tiger did. And the longest active streak on tour right now is Xander Schauffele, who has 39 in a row that he's had. 39. So no one's close to that 142. And to get there today, Tiger's had to play 13 holes of golf. Now, or that's not right. Tiger had to play the 18 today, and then I think 12 or 13 after that. Prior to today, Tiger had only played 24 holes of golf all year. So on a hilly course like Augusta, it might not sound like much. Oh, Tiger's got to play more than 18. Who cares? Play 24 holes of golf. Who really cares? It's just golf. This is a hilly course, and Tiger had the car crash, and it's not easy. You don't get carts when you play in Augusta. So for him to complete today's round, given how windy the conditions have been, 20, 30 mile an hour winds whipping throughout the day, that is an achievement for Tiger. And since he's probably not going to contend for a green jacket, it is about that time to start wondering about Pinehurst. The U.S. Open, a couple of months away, it's in North Carolina, and that course, it's not as physically demanding. It's not going to tax Tiger as much as Augusta will. So could we see Tiger Woods play in the state of North Carolina at least one more time? That is something that I don't think it's too soon to begin having that conversation, but Tiger making it to the weekend, a win for golf, a win for him certainly, and one of the bigger stories in Augusta the first couple of days of competition. Cam Newton deployed a hot, borderline reckless take about the Carolina Panthers this week that you need to hear. We will play that for you, and we will react next on The Drive.
A tradition unlike any other.
Thread the drive down between the majestic pines, down towards the left edge of that right bunker.
A week where good is just not good enough.
Avoid the left because it rolls down into the little stream down there in the pine straw.
From the dogwoods to the doglegs, it's time to bring your best.
That is the 21st hole-in-one of the 16th. Bryson DeChambeau.
WSJS is proud to bring you updates of the 88. We'll deliver updates twice an hour, and we'll recap the day with the Masters tonight at 10 p.m.
320 would be a great shot, leaving an opening to the green.
All made possible by Jason's Deli of Winston-Salem. It's a family thing. YMCA of Northwest North Carolina. By Ace, the place with the helpful hardware folks on Robin Hood Road.
A left to right wind, working it back. So there we go. Very good.
And WSJS.
Art Fields 2024. Lake City, South Carolina transforms into a living art gallery as they recognize, celebrate, and share the artistic talent of the Southeast. Over 400 works of art will be on display from renovated 1920s warehouses, Lake City's art galleries, restaurants, boutiques, and shops. You're going to find inspiring art, live entertainment, and local food on every corner. Art Fields Competition and Festival is April 26th through May the 4th, and it's free. Lake City, South Carolina, a charming southern art town, Art Fields 2024.
Mountaineers, make sure you don't miss the upcoming Champion of the Rock event on July 26th in the Grandview Ballroom in Kid Brewer Stadium. Enjoy a night full of casino-style games and a poker tournament to determine who the Champion of the Rock really is. All proceeds will benefit at-state student-athletes. Visit MountaineersAthleticFund.com for more information or to register. Space is limited. Inquire now.
You can do it all by yourself, baby girl. What's your name? Let me talk to you. Let me buy you a drink.
Spilled your drink? Quick, the quicker picker-upper. Bounty picks up spills quicker. And each sheet is 2 times more absorbent, so you can use less than the leading ordinary brand. So, you can get back to your night. Bounty, the quicker picker-upper.
What's that sound? That's the sound of Downy Unstoppable Scent Beads going into your washing machine and giving your clothes freshness that lasts all day long. There it is again. It's like music to your ears, or more like music to your nose. That freshness is irresistible. Let's get a Downy Unstoppables bottle shake. And now a sniff solo. Nice. Get 6 times longer lasting freshness plus odor protection with Downy Unstoppables in wash scent beads.
This is it. Ready?
All right, hold on.
All right, do it, do it, do it.
All right, listen up.
This is The Drive with Josh Graham.
Wake Forest golf coach Jerry Haas, 15 minutes from now, watching a few of his guys at Augusta National, round 2 of the Masters today. We'll have another update courtesy of Westwood One shortly. Cam Newton still isn't over being left. Cam Newton still isn't over being let go by the Carolina Panthers 4 years ago. Some of that came out in an interview with Shannon Sharp on his podcast. And it's a revisionist history that is misleading and in some cases, reckless. He begins by suggesting the Panthers made a giant mistake by blowing things up after the 2019 season and then hiring Matt Rhule and resetting then.
We have to start holding these people in management accountable. You should not have cleaned your house like you clean your house. Getting rid of a Ryan Khalil impacted that offensive line. Getting rid of a Thomas Davis impacted that defense, not just the linebackers. Losing Luke, how you lost Luke.
Okay. These, the revisionist history piece of this. Ryan Khalil said he wasn't going to return and that he was going to retire before they pressed the reset button. We knew going into his final game against the Saints that Ryan Khalil was retiring. And then he decided during training camp the next year, oh, I still want to play. I still got that itch. And the Panthers already had a center at that point. So he played for the New York Jets. So that piece seems a little off. Context is important there. Thomas Davis was let go. But really, was that the wrong decision? He didn't do anything with the Chargers or Washington. He was washed at that point. This is the thing. Aaron Rodgers, when he had the press conference going into his last season in Green Bay, he was upset with management because they let go of Jordy Nelson and let go of Randall Cobb and let go of some of these vets that Aaron Rodgers was friends with. These guys, there's a reason why they're not the GM, because they just keep all their friends around. Oh, yeah. We're all friends here, and you let these guys go, and man, these guys, they're all so great until they're not. And it's management's job to decide when they are no longer great. And both with Ryan Khalil and Thomas Davis, it was time. It also ignores, Cam ignores here, the primary reason they had to rebuild, which was Cam couldn't stay healthy. It was his shoulder deteriorating in 2018 and 2019. It was the foot the foot being such, had him out after the second game of that season too. Cam couldn't stay healthy. If he did stay healthy, Ron Rivera's not fired. The Panthers might be a playoff team. Cam Newton might have finished his career a Panther without having been shipped off to Foxborough after 2019. That opinion, though, is harmless. Okay. Context is needed, but that's not a reckless opinion to have. Then, getting to Luke Kuechly, which he kind of alluded to there, he suggests Luke Kuechly may have not retired if some of those guys stayed.
Luke retired, right? But I do think Luke would not have retired if he knew that locker room was still going to be intact. He probably would have took some time off, right? And his health isn't important, you know, taking concussions extremely serious. But that would have been something that you would have had to consider, being a Luke Kuechly, knowing that I still got KK Short, I still got Charles Johnson, I still got Thomas Davis, I still got guys that's gonna battle with me. You dig what I'm saying? Julius Peppers. They all left. And these are the things that he had to think back and say, hold on, we ain't got none of that. I gotta start over. Nah, I'm good with that.
What? Julius Peppers, we also knew was retiring at the end of 2019. What is Cam talking about? Oh, you know, if Julius Peppers would have... He's painting a picture that the Panthers bumped out Ryan Khalil and Julius Peppers. That's just not true. It's not. It's not how it happened. This is a lot like the Russell Wilson story, where the national story was told, the national perception told by Russell Wilson was that Tom O'Brien pushed him out. The truth is, well, you said that you weren't going to be a part of spring practice and then played pro baseball and then said you wanted to return. And we already had a quarterback at that point who was a part of spring practice that turned out to be an NFL player in Mike Glennon. That doesn't sound as good. That's not as good of a story as, oh, NC State didn't want Russ. Ha ha. So Cam's painting this picture that the Panthers bumped all these guys out, which did not happen. Oh, there were no vets in that room. That's why Luke retired. What about Shaq Thompson? What about Trey Boston? Those guys were back too. And also, by the way, the start of his premise, we got to hold these guys accountable. Marty Herney was held accountable. Scott Fitterer's not around anymore. Is he talking about Tepper? Is that who Cam's talking about there? Who isn't held accountable? And secondarily, the things that he's arguing at the end, the points that he's making about Luke and Thomas and all, that that doesn't necessarily argue well the point that he's trying to make, that the Panthers should not have rebooted the way that they did. Oh, man. Like, he's just saying that these guys, they moved off of. Luke Kuechly retiring does not argue your point well that you should not have rebuilt. Like, if Luke Kuechly came back, is that Carolina Panthers team with Matt Rhule all of the sudden good? Is Luke Kuechly worth 4 more wins? I don't think so. This is the truth. This is the reality. The rebuild was defensible. So was moving off of Cam. That was defensible. They just hired the wrong coach. And maybe they didn't bottom out the way they should have. You signed a quarterback in Teddy Bridgewater that was just good enough for you guys to win 5 games. If you were worse, you probably draft Justin Herbert or Tua. But you were too good to draft any of those guys after the first season. You know, it could be like the trade last year where some are saying, revisionist, oh, the Panthers made a great mistake trading DJ Moore. No, they didn't. They were right to trade DJ Moore for the number one pick. If Bryce Young doesn't pan out, you're not going to be lamenting the trade. You're going to be lamenting the pick. You chose the wrong quarterback. In this case, rebuilding was the right decision. You might have just hired the wrong coach, which is what you should lament, not the rebuild. Speaking of Bryce Young, here was Cam again on Club Shay Shay, offering advice to Bryce.
Well, I remember having a conversation with brief conversation with him and during Super Bowl. I saw him at a party, and I think he needs to understand that voicing his opinion is important. Bryce has to obviously be open to doing it, not doing it publicly,
right?
Right, but doing it behind the scenes to say, listen, if we got this person in the draft, this is who I want.
Right.
That, like, I need to be protected.
And it looks like he's going to be with what they added up front and how they've invested in the offensive line. Cam Newton with some Carolina Panthers takes with Shannon Sharp. WD, try not to shed a tear, but the Hornet season's going to end this weekend.
What just happened?
They are at Boston tonight. They are at
Boston,
Cleveland on Sunday. They're not going to win either of those games, especially with the Celtics losing last night. Sorry to Charlotte. You're going to finish your season 20-62.
Oof.
But there is a chance to finish your season strong if you're Brandon Miller. Fresh off winning the Eastern Conference Rookie of the Month. Month of March. I think it's the third time he's won that award in the Eastern Conference this year. He is averaging 20 points per game on the dot since February. There was a suggestion this week that Brandon Miller, not the best rookie, that's Victor Wembanyama, not the second best. Okay, there's Chet Holmgren. For some reason, he's considered a rookie, even though he was taken in last year's draft. Not the third best rookie, not the fourth best rookie, the fifth best rookie. Some suggest he might even be second team all rookie. What?
Wait, who's the third and the fourth best on those lists?
Didn't get that far because I was so mad at just the suggestion. Expect him to have a night tonight.
What just happened?
My reaction exactly when I saw that suggestion. The playoffs begin next weekend. The Charlotte Hornets will not be part of it. We don't count the play-in, so it's been 8 years since Charlotte's last been in a playoff. What playoff was that? That was facing Dwayne Wade in the Miami Heat, 2016. They're up 3-2. You're at home. You're trying to close it out. And then our version of Spike Lee agitating Reggie Miller in the playoffs, leading to Reggie giving Spike Lee the choke sign as the Knicks collapsed. Purple shirt guy was standing up courtside, got into Dwayne Wade's ear, and then Dwayne Wade went off. And Charlotte lost that game and then lost in game 7 of that series. Charlotte has not been to the playoffs since then. 8 long years. I don't know how long it takes to teach someone how to swim. A lot shorter than 8 years, I'm pretty sure, though. That's where the folks at the local Y come in. Summer sports registration is already in place, but they are teaching young people to swim as they've been doing for such a long time and doing so in an atmosphere that builds confidence for young people. WD learned to swim at the local Y when he was growing up. And if you have a child or somebody that needs to learn how to swim, something as simple as that, sign up at the YMCA, getting ready for the summer, www.ymcanwnc.org.
Call the Amazon driver. He's still ticked the purple shirt guy.
Oh, yeah. Hornet fans know.
Yeah.
This is why us being the longest running sports show in the history of the Triad, going on 6 years or whatnot, it carries weight when we remember things like purple shirt guy. Real ones know. Real ones also know how good Wake Forest golf is and how historic that program is. With two pro deeks in the mix at Augusta National this week, Wake coach Jerry Haas joins us next on The Drive.
From the Augusta National Golf Club, Westwood One Sports presents this special report on the Masters. I'm Ted Emmerich. Tiger Woods is grinding on day two. He played 5 holes this morning to wrap up his first round. Then less than an hour between that and teeing off in the second round. Not ideal for a 48-year-old with a surgically repaired back, knee, and ankle, even if he is a 15-time major champion. Woods dealing with a difficult hole location at the par 3 16th. He landed his tee shot hole high, looking for back-to-back birdies.
This putt going to move a whole lot to the right here
for Tiger. One last look at the hole. And it's just outside 20 feet. Here we go. Down the hill, breaking to the right. He's already lost it to the right-hand side. But the speed is good. If anything, it's again short. You guys have not gotten the ball to the hole as aggressively as normal, but it'll be a tap-in par for Tiger on the toughest hole location that 16 has to offer. He stays one over par for the tournament.
Brian Kaetrick, the call on SiriusXM. Plus one for Tiger is 8 off the lead, but plus one is well within the cut line, which is projected at 4 over at the moment. Tiger looking to break the Masters record with his 24th consecutive made cut. You're listening to coverage of the 2024 Masters on Westwood One.
Want to keep your gas-powered engines running like new? Stables' proprietary formulas are proven by third-party tests.
Yes, loves expanding your business, evolving your passions. We push what technology can do, so great ideas can happen right now. Find out how to bring your ideas to life at Dell.com. Welcome to now.
Bryson DeChambeau and Scottie Scheffler are in front here in the second round at the Masters. The leaderboard sponsored by Stable. Every love when you store, start with Stable. Visit Stable.com for more information. DeChambeau and Scheffler both at 7-under. Beautiful par save from Scheffler at 4. He missed the green, but he pitched his second to within 6 feet, made the putt, so Scheffler still tied for the lead. Max Homa, 1 back at 6-under. He's 1-under today through 16 at 4-under par. Nikolai Højgaard, Danny Willett, Ryan Fox, 3-under par. Cameron Davis, Patrick Cantlay. From Augusta, I'm Ted Emmerich, Westwood One Sports.
The Drive with Josh Graham, only on WSJM.
Since it's Masters weekend, let's chat with the coach of one of the nation's preeminent golf programs. It's Jerry Haas from Wake Forest Men's Golf, joining the show now. Coach, I'm curious, how are you spending Masters weekend?
Well, I hung out with the guys yesterday here at the Arnold Palmer Golf Complex at Wake Forest, and we all had the TV going, and we're watching two of our deacons there, Cameron Young and Will Zalatoris, making some birdies. So we had a good day. It was very windy. Windy again today, but got actually a couple players that went down there to watch. So you learn a lot when you see them in person, and I think it helps everybody who loves to play golf.
Do you reach out to Will Zalatoris or Cam Young the week of the tournament?
Not the week of the tournament, no. I obviously talk to them periodically throughout the year with texts and things that come up, articles, you know, let them know how the team's doing, but We're all very proud of them, back-to-back rookies of the year. And, you know, all of them, Webb Simpson, Bill, Kyle Reifers, just goes on and on and on, all the good players that Wake has produced. And no better place than Augusta National to watch a couple Demon Deacons play.
You and I were chatting a few years ago after both of them performed so well in Augusta. Individually, what suits their games well for this golf course?
Well, a couple things. Their length, number one. I would say Will's ability to shape the ball left to right or right to left. He's a pretty good shot maker. And he looks like this new putter is really working for him. His stroke looks great. And Cameron, on the other hand, is so explosive. He could run off three birdies and an eagle on, you know, a four-hole stretch. And he likes to hit a hot draw or a high, hard draw, and that's perfect for Augusta National. I think Cameron will be a little bit more how his putter treats him. If he putts well, he'll be right up there towards the end of the week.
Jerry Haas with us, Wake Forest golf coach. What do you remember about your first visit to Augusta National?
Well, my one and only visit, I was a semifinalist in the U.S. Amateur. And once you got your exemption, you had up until the tournament to play unlimited practice rounds. I was a senior at Wake Forest, and I only went once, kind of after exams. My brother Jay said, let's go down and play. And we played, I think it was December 15th or 16th, you know, prior months before it. And the fairways were kind of long and the greens weren't that fast. And I'm like, well, this is not that, you know, big a deal. And then turn around the week before the Masters in 1985, I played at the Furman Invitational at the Furman Golf Course. And then I drove over on that Sunday night. I went to the putting green to hit a few putts. And the first one I putted, I just clearly putted it right off the green. And there was one other guy on the green. He kind of smiled at me from a distance. And we putted for a while. And eventually we came near each other. And it was, he put his hand out and he introduced himself. It was Bernhard Langer, who ended up winning that week. So it was a big difference from December to April, that's for sure. But stayed in the crow's nest with John Inman and Scott Verplank. And it was a great week. And always look forward to it. I still have a Masters robe in my closet that I maybe somehow got into my bag. So hopefully the statute of limitations have passed and they won't hunt me down for that robe. But I was going to wear it to work today, but I'm like, no, I'm not going to do that.
Next time, let's do this. If one of your guys wins a major championship, we're going to get you on the show in the Masters robe. That's what we're going to do.
That's a deal. I'll get them on the show and they'll put the robe on. So that'd be even better.
They might have their own if you win the championship.
That's true. That's true.
How different were the scorecards in December versus April?
A little different. Obviously December was a little cooler. I remember the tournament week, the ball was going pretty well, running, and obviously the fastest greens I'd ever putted. And I'm sure they're so much faster even today. But at that time, a long time ago, having fast greens. But, you know, at the end of the day on fast greens, it's basically you have to hit it about 3 feet and it goes about 30 sometimes, or, you know, 15 or whatever. So if you've got a pretty steady hand and you can start them on the lines with the correct speed, you make a lot of putts. And I think you saw that yesterday. There was a lot of birdies and eagles made. But it'll play different each and every day. I think the wind will probably be up a little bit today, I heard, and then this weekend should be a great shootout. It should start drying out a little bit more, and I think we're in for a great event. I mean, Scottie Scheffler continues to amaze up there, and a good start for Bryson. So and many times too, those guys had hot first rounds. It's sometimes hard to back it up, so who knows what could be leading by the end of the night.
Jerry Haas with us here on WSJS. You mentioned the crow's nest staying in there. A lot of people listening to our voices right now have no idea what that room looks like. What's something about that room that stands out to you that maybe someone who's never been there might not appreciate?
Well, it's right above the clubhouse, number one, and there's no frills about it. Back in the day, it was just kind of like a bed that sat against the wall, and there was like a little draw curtain, and you had one little light above your bed. And if I remember right, there was six beds. And a lot of players didn't want to stay up there. But like I said, Scott Verplank, myself, John Inman, who later became the North Carolina golf coach, we stayed up there. And they had guards down below, almost that kind of guarded the clubhouse. But we would come down at night, we'd sneak down the steps, and then he'd pretty much tell us we need to go back up to our room. So we weren't allowed to roam around the clubhouse at night. I do remember the USGA, they had a big thing on amateur golfers, and if you took any money, then you lose your amateur status. So Augusta National charged us. They said, okay, we'll get around that. So they charged us $1 a night to stay there. and then breakfast was $1, lunch was $1, and dinner was $1. So my bill for the week was $31. I remember that. And I was like, wow, that was pretty good to stay up there. It's a cool thing. I've since been up there again and just walked up there and kind of reminisced, but it's a lot better now. There's kind of doors on each little room, but it's still the same thing. It's updated, obviously, but it's still the same place. It was a pretty cool experience when I look back on it, and very lucky to get to do that.
This might sound like a really dumb question, but it's a practical question I need the answer to. What's the bathroom situation when you got six beds up there?
One shower and one bath around the corner.
Oh, no. So,
but that's not a problem.
Okay, know? Understood. Yeah. Jerry Haas with us here. On the way out, you are a huge sports fan. It's one of my favorite things about you. Did you have any other sports takes that you wanted to get out of your system, maybe about your Cardinals or something of that sort?
No, I think the Cardinals, I think they're 6-7, got a 3-game set starting tonight against, I think, the Diamondbacks.
Yeah.
But their pitching is much better, and I think they're going to have a really nice year if they stay healthy. That division's good. The Pirates are off to a great start, and which I'm happy to see for them. So I think the Cards might be in the cellar at 6-7, but that just shows it's a pretty good division. The Reds are better. But the Cubs have been good lately. So I've got enjoyed the NCAA basketball. I like you said, I love sports and watch the Masters this week. And, you know, whatever's on, I'm watching it. So we got the ACC championship next week over at Charlotte. Yeah, Charlotte Country Club. Very excited about that. It's obviously one of the premier courses in North Carolina, and sure, it'll be in great shape, and they'll be an unbelievable host for the ACC championship. So if you're in the Charlotte area, you're going to see, you know, some really good golf teams and some really good players. But, you know, we'll be talking about them playing in the Masters here in years to come.
Jerry Haas, I hope to see you next week in a Masters robe, because Will Zalatoris or Cam Young is having a green jacket slipped on their shoulders. If not, I hope to see you sometime soon. Best of luck in the ACC championships next week in Charlotte. And thanks so much for the visit.
Thank you very much for having me on, and love your show, and love talking about sports. Deeks.
Yes, go Deeks. Jerry Haas, Wake golf coach, joining us. He's a huge Cardinal fan. My Orioles, they completed a sweep of the Red Sox last night.
Yes, I got the Kimbrel photo last night.
Oh, yeah. Willow the dog in both the pictures.
She ain't having it.
No.
She's not. She's like, what are you doing?
She does not like the Kimbrel pose, but it went to extras, and the Orioles scored 6 in the top of the 10th. Wild, crazy games that they've had. Jackson Holliday is going to make his home debut tonight.
Oh, boy.
Still hasn't had a hit.
That's going to be a madhouse. He was just waiting for the home debut.
That's what I'm saying. Scored a couple of runs last night. This is a fun team to watch. It's great. The game is on Apple TV Plus.
Do you have that?
No.
Are you going to get it for tonight?
Hey, I'm looking into this camera here.
Uh-huh.
If anyone has an Apple TV login that I could just use for tonight, I'm not interested in watching Ted Lasso or whatever, hit me up. HMU. Do that. So the Orioles are playing this is what's interesting. The Orioles are playing the Brewers tonight. Mm-hmm. And they're going up against a pitcher named DL Hall, who the Orioles traded in the Corbin Burns trade. So Burns, I think, is scheduled to go on Sunday against his former team. But you've got the Orioles are facing one of their former guys from last year that they traded away to bring in Burns.
Yankees are in Cleveland tonight.
That's it. Guardians.
Yep.
Later. Atlanta. Happy to see the Miami Marlins after Atlanta got trounced by the Mets yesterday and blew a lead a few nights ago with Morton on the mound. So, yeah, it's a big baseball night. Excited for it. A quick message from our friends at Tar Heel Basement Systems. We all know that high mortgage rates can be a real drag, and we know how high they've been lately. Because of that, most homeowners are staying put, investing into and preserving the home they have. If you're ignoring any cracked bricks, basement floor, or concrete cracks, you could be ignoring underlying foundation problems. Tar Heel Basement Systems know these signs lead to irreversible damage that could cause a reduction in your home's value. Don't wait any longer to have Tar Heel Basement Systems come out and inspect the problem. The team's experts will identify your home's issue at the source. Visit TarHeelBasementSystems.com today to book your free inspection with a no-obligation quote included. Tar Heel Basement Systems. There's a reason why they're the local trusted experts. Trusted local experts. Coming up, Beth Betts. Cue up the JC horn for tonight.
Cash out, fam.
And the door has been left open for the Carolina Hurricanes this weekend. Keep it here on The Drive.
When is the last time you've checked out our website? Yeah, it's all new.
That's awesome.
It appears that the website has become alive.
What are you waiting for? You can listen to us live anytime or all the time at WSJS.com.
Oh, sweet.
Listen to us on your desktop, laptop, tablet, or smartphone.
Take a one line with them any day.
Log in and listen now at WSJS.com. Your online home for news, talk, and sports.
Art Fields 2024. Lake City, South Carolina transforms into a living art gallery as they recognize, celebrate, and share the artistic talent of the Southeast. Over 400 works of art will be on display from renovated 1920s warehouses, Lake City's art galleries, restaurants, boutiques, and shops. You're going to find inspiring art, live entertainment, and local food on every corner. Art Fields Competition and Festival is April 26th through May the 4th, and it's free. Lake City, South Carolina, a charming southern art town. Art Fields 2024.
Hello, this is Daniel Hautry. I am pastor at the Kerwin Baptist Church in Kernersville, North Carolina. Sunday, April the 28th at 5 p.m., we are having church at the park. This is at Harmon Park, downtown Kernersville. We're going to have hot dog drinks, bounce houses for the kids. We have a handbell choir that will be performing. Our choir will be singing. We have a Christian illusionist coming, and we just want you to know that you're invited. Again, it's April the 28th at 5 p.m., church at the park, downtown Kernersville, Harmon Park.
Close your eyes and imagine you're surrounded by thousands of passionate fans, energy rushing through your veins, and you're cheering on Carolina Core FC, your new men's professional soccer team. Carolina Core FC is the Triads team, the Triads party. They are part of the MLS Next Pro Soccer League, and Truist Point will be the home pitch. Learn more and get tickets at CarolinaCoreFC.com. That's CarolinaCoreFC.com.
Let's get this party started!
Honey, we should get some new kitchen cabinets. Now, before you go, oh no, and your wallet cringes, U.S. Cabinet Express in High Point has the solution. How? They're going to take the complication out of buying kitchen and bathroom cabinets with a free design consultation and a price breakdown for all cabinetry. Plus, take advantage of $0 down and 0% financing for 18 months. Now relax, take a deep breath, and visit the beautiful U.S. Cabinet Express showroom in High Point. Or go to uscabinetsexpress.net. That's uscabinetsexpress.net.
Hi, everyone. It's Jill here from The Jill Berlin Show. Tune in and enjoy a positive quote, a unique story from a local guest hero, and great information about current health insurance tips and highlights. Let's honor the men and women who have overcome obstacles and have proven to be people that we can admire. On The Jill Berlin Show, Thursday mornings at 9, here on WSJS.
All right, I think all the levels are set.
Showtime.
Now, right now.
You're on The Drive with Josh Graham.
You've grown quite a bit, young Padawan Will. There were times you'd play this bump on days that were not Friday.
I know.
It would really bother me. It should be a felony to play this song, Friday I'm in Love, any day but on Friday. And it especially hits and resonates today, Friday of the Masters, and the weather is perfect in Augusta. The weather's pretty darn good outside here as well. Once we get off the air today, while I'm wearing Grimsley lacrosse gear, what's the number one rule of this show?
If you give us gear, we will wear it, we will display it, and we will eat it if it's food.
That's right. That is the number one rule that we follow here. After I get off the air today, going to be playing pickleball. Pickleball Fridays.
Ah.
You need to participate one of these times.
I know. I need to get out there.
Pickleball Friday. Willow the dog might be coming to the park too.
Ho, ho, ho.
Just got an update. Good report from the dog walker today. So we'll reward her with some pickleball court time. She's a pretty good player. We're pretty good when it comes to handing out bets. And we got a few to hand out for tonight in Best Bets right now.
I'm not a betting duck.
Care to make it interesting?
You know you do.
You're on. Count me in on this.
Your best bet.
But my money's on the other team.
This is Josh's Best Bets.
We split last night. Grayson Rodriguez did go under on the strikeouts while my Orioles went on to sweep. That hit. And then the Rangers lost to the Philadelphia Flyers. It's positive for the Carolina Hurricanes, though, which we'll get to shortly. So 1-1 last night with the picks that we handed out. Tonight we got two to hand out in the NBA. We do not like the Charlotte Hornets against the Boston Celtics tonight. It's a stinky poo line of 8.5 points. The Celtics, they don't care anymore. They're just waiting for the playoffs to get here. They have the best record in the West, or the best record any team in the West or East, best record in the league, and it's not close. They played last night. What type of team you're going to get, I don't know. We like Brandon Miller over 18.5 points tonight. He's averaging 20 a game since February. He's averaging 23 over the last five. So we think he hits 20 points again, over 18.5 points for Hornets rookie Brandon Miller, looking to close his rookie campaign strong.
Give me that cash up, fam.
Elsewhere. Somebody help me make this line make sense. The Magic are playing the Sixers. Have you looked at the Eastern Conference standings going into the weekend? The Magic is tied with the Pacers for the number 5 spot in the East, which means one will finish 5th, one will finish 6th if the season ended today. 2 games to go. The 6th best team, or pardon me, the 7th team in the East standings is the Philadelphia 76ers. They're a game back of both Indiana and Orlando. Whoever ends up in that 7 spot out of those 3 teams has to play in the play-in tournament. You don't want that to happen. Philadelphia is at home tonight against Orlando. That's ahead of them in the standings. This is a very important basketball game. Orlando has been better than Philly for a lot of this season. That's why they're in front of them in the standings at this point. Philadelphia is favored by 7.5 points. Give me that candy. We're going with Orlando, probably to win the game, but we'll just take the points when you give us too many.
Send me that cash up, fam.
Orlando, the Magic, Paolo Banchero and company, plus 7.5 against the Sixers tonight. So there you go. Those are the two that we like. You can parlay them together if you want. Or if you want to bet them with the Orioles tonight, yeah, you could do that too. The O's. They're getting a 1.5 for some reason. Don't remember the last time that happened with the O's, so I'm not going to miss out on that opportunity. That's Best Bets for tonight's action. As mentioned, the door has been left open for the Carolina Hurricanes. The Rangers, with their loss last night to the Philadelphia Flyers, have lost 2 in a row, which means their lead over Carolina in the division, the Metro Division, is just 3 points. Carolina has a game in hand on the Rangers. The Canes, here's what they really need. They need the Rangers to lose one of their last 2 games. Carolina probably has to win out. They probably have to win their 3 remaining games. If the Rangers lose both of their last 2, which is unlikely given the Rangers are really good and they're at home for their last 2 games. But if that were to happen, Carolina then only has to win 2 of their last 3 to lock up their 4th straight Metro Division title. Carolina starts off this 3-game run to close the regular season in St. Louis tonight. You had forgotten.
No, sometimes I like to let it play out a little bit there. Let it breathe.
St. Louis is the biggest challenge to the Hurricanes tonight. Chicago and Columbus are the last 2. They are both not good hockey teams. Bad hockey teams, those 2. If they win the division, they be in Carolina. Their opponent could be one of two teams, I believe. It'll be either Washington or Philly. If they don't win the division, then it's going to be the New York Islanders that they get in round one of the Stanley Cup playoffs. It's here pretty much. Stanley Cup playoffs, NBA playoffs, it's pretty much arrived. With the passing of O.J. Simpson yesterday, I watched the first three parts of that O.J. Made in America documentary. Man, it's so good.
My game plan is to take a look at some of it over the weekend.
I don't believe you for one second.
I get, and I understand why.
Because every single time you've said this, I come in on Monday. Hey, how was that? Oh, I didn't do that. Why? Because I'm playing video games.
I understand why you feel that way. It is warranted. However, I really would like to take a look at this documentary. So I do plan to watch some of it.
Where's the JC Horn drop?
Send me that cash up.
I will put the cash
up. Plus 200 odds.
Yep.
That he does not finish this documentary series.
Well, I'm not going to finish it.
See, I watched.
Not over the weekend, anyway.
It's five 90-minute episodes.
Yeah.
I had a church group, as we have each week, come over to our house. Great night. And then they left at around 9. So I turned on one. And then I turned on a second one. And it's about 12:10 at night in the morning. And I decide, you know what? I could do one more as I'm doing some work and knock out some stuff as I'm, you know, cleaning up the downstairs or whatever. So until about 2 o'clock this morning, it's just enthralling. And so I have two more episodes I need to watch that I plan on watching tonight amidst all these sporting events as well. But that documentary, it's just magic. Everybody they get and the things that they get out of those people, it might be the best sports documentary that I've ever seen. Plenty else for us to accomplish. Boy, is it windy.
Look at that.
Tiger Woods has got his hand on his face to protect himself from some of the sand flying up from the trap. He's on 18, getting set to finish a hole. They have a camera on the sand trap, and it looks just crazy right now at Augusta. When that subsides, Tiger is going to finish up 18. It's not a long putt that he has, and if he hits it, he'll finish the day at one over, or finish the first two rounds at one over, three clear of the cut and making his 24th consecutive cut. So we'll have that update in the Big Four when we get to that, unless Westwood One steals my thunder in just a few seconds. With that, we have Hayes Permar, who's going to join us later. We'll play Skips or Plays with Hayes. Keep it simple this hour's WD's favorite segment of the week. One of my favorites is Rhinestone Cowboy. It is Rhinestone Cowboy Friday, after all. The Big Four opens up hour two of the show. Hey, Tiger just hit it. Plus one through two rounds, he has the record for the most consecutive cuts made at the Masters.
From the Augusta National Golf Club, Westwood One Sports presents this special report on the Masters. I'm Ted Emmerich. Leaders coming back to the field in the second round. First, Bryson DeChambeau with a bogey at 11. Moments later, on the other side of the course, Scottie Scheffler horseshoed a three-foot putt for par at 5, his first bogey of the week. So, a three-way tie for first with DeChambeau, Scheffler, and Max Homa. But DeChambeau dialed in his tee shot at 12, and he had a look at a bounce-back birdie.
From 9 feet behind the hole, strokes it on its way out into the sun and down into the dark. That's a birdie for Bryson DeChambeau, two at 12, and he's back to 7 under par.
John McGinnis, the call on SiriusXM. That was DeChambeau's score to start the second round. He was alone at the top after 18 holes, and DeChambeau is alone at the top right now. You're listening to coverage of the 2024 Masters on Westwood One.
The less your business spends, the more margin you keep. But today, everything costs more. So smart businesses are graduating to NetSuite by Oracle. NetSuite is the number one cloud financial system, bringing accounting, financial management, inventory, HR into one proven platform, helping you reduce IT costs, maintenance costs, and manual errors. Over 37,000 companies have already made the move to NetSuite. Now through April 15th, NetSuite is offering a one-of-a-kind flexible financing program. Head to netsuite.com/golf right now. netsuite.com/golf.
For the ones who work hard to ensure their crew can always go the extra mile, and the ones who get in early so everyone can go home on time, there's Grainger, offering professional-grade supplies backed by product experts so you can quickly and easily find what you need. Plus, you can count on access to a committed team ready to go the extra mile for you. Call, click Grainger.com, or just stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
Wind is still picking up here in the second round at Augusta National. The gusts will reach 40 miles an hour as the afternoon continues. Let's check the leaderboard sponsored by NetSuite. Head to netsuite.com/golf now through April 15th for a one-of-a-kind flexible financing program. And the scores reflect that. There are not many low rounds out there on the course. Bryson DeChambeau leads at 7-under. He's even today through 12. Max Homa, Scottie Scheffler, one back at 6-under. Homa, 1-under for the day as he plays 18. Scheffler's even today through 6. Nikolai Højgaard with back-to-back bogeys at 17 and 18 to finish his round. It's a 1-over-73 for the Dane, making his Masters debut. He's 4-under for the week and 3-back. Danny Willett, 4-under as well, and 3-off the lead. Ryan Fox is -4. Tiger Woods playing 18. He's 1-over for the tournament, but he will make the cut for a Masters record 24th consecutive time. From Augusta, I'm Ted Emmerich, Westwood One Sports.
Hear about it, talk about it. WSJS Winston-Salem, Greensboro, High Point, Burlington. Online at WSJS.com.
It's The Drive with Josh Graham, WSJS.
Sailing with the pilot for the sea.
The big four.
Big Four, brought to you by Budget Blinds of North Winston-Salem and Mount Airy, serving Northern Forsyth, Stokes, and Surrey counties. Online at budgetblinds.com.
The Big Four, presented by Budget Blinds. Online, budgetblinds.com. That's where you go to look at their inventory and learn about their in-home consultations, as they have so many different options and solutions for whatever you might need with your windows and how you dress them. Shades, blinds, drapes, you name them. The Big Four gives us a chance to tell you what's going on in sports today. What is number four on the Big Four?
So taking a look at tonight's schedule, I'm a little bummed out because the Yankees were supposed to play the Guardians in Cleveland. Pretty similar records. Yankees 10-3, Guardians 9-3. They've been hot. Postponed, apparently due to rain. So I'm a little bummed out about that. But you do have Hornets, Celtics.
You weren't going to watch that game.
Why not?
How were you going to watch that game?
I mean, I'm sure I could have found a way to watch. I don't know what channel it was supposed to come on, but
the YES Network?
I could have found a way to probably get it on.
I just had to get it on.
I did. I would have.
What else is there?
You got the Hornets at Boston tonight at the Celtics. I guess that's fun. That's fun.
Boston.
Get to hear Eric Collins again on the call.
Last time you'll get to hear Eric Collins this weekend.
Yeah, Hornets sitting at 20-60 on their season right now. Not great. And then you also have the Canes. They're at St. Louis at the Blues.
I do remember you trying to tell me that the Hornets were good. Remember that couple-week stretch where you had a small sample size and you said how great they were?
Well, I didn't say great.
You said they were good.
I thought they were at the time. I have since changed my opinion on that due to a larger sample size. Also, if you want to extend today's schedule into some live action.
It's live action, Tracy.
Guess where Wake Forest is currently leading 3-0?
That would be Boston College.
Boston College.
3-0, top four, ACC Network. Extra, I think that is.
Go Deeks, go. Chase Burns on the mound today. Saw he had an error, but seems to have regained himself and hasn't allowed any runs thus far.
And your O's tonight against the Brewers on Apple TV. Good luck trying to watch that one.
Gotten about 3 text messages from people saying, I got you, fam. So,
well, if anybody has YES Network, let me know.
They don't.
Maybe Iron Eagle has it. He's up that way. He's on Yes Network. He's got to have some type of something for me.
I imagine he has a login, but
yeah.
I don't know if that helps you in North Carolina, number one. And number two, first thing he tell you is, what Thinking Man picture are you going to be watching this weekend?
WD needs more of a Thinking Man picture.
The answer to that, do you remember?
Yeah, it wasn't Kill Bill.
No, that wasn't even up for the poll this week.
What was the movie I'm supposed to be watching again?
See, this is you. This is so you. You don't even know, and then Monday's going to roll around. Oh, yeah, I'll do that tonight. And I know you way too well in your procrastination. Listen, it's American Pie.
American Pie.
That's your movie.
I would have remembered it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Obviously.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. Gonna watch going on. The OJ series. Cool.
Yes.
Got it. Understood. What number are we at?
3.
Still?
Yep. Well, we just got here. Anyway, let's get to some college basketball news that I'm sure plenty of people around here would be interested in. Jared McCain, Kyle Filipowski, both the Duke's top scorers this year, have announced, to nobody's surprise, I think, they're heading to the NBA draft. Flip finished up his year leading Duke in scoring with 16.4 points a game, 8.3 rebounds. McCain had 14.3 points per game. But some other news regarding Duke: Tyrese Proctor is coming back to Duke next year, which I don't think he was ready to go pro. I don't think he was ready. I don't think he had a great year compared to...
If you were going to be a first-round draft pick, it's a surprise you're coming back. And I thought he was going to go in the first round of this year's draft.
I felt like he underperformed this year.
I would agree with that. Both those things can be true.
Yeah.
Jalen Johnson, how good was he at Duke during the COVID year? Pretty bad. And then he quit on the team. And then was a top 10 pick. And that looks like it's a pretty good pick. The NBA, since when do they care how good of a year you had in college? That's not necessarily what interests them all that much. It is nuts to me that Duke has 6 freshmen in this class. Why? That many freshmen? Half your roster freshmen? It does limit what Shire can do, and it's going to lead to some uncomfortable conversations in the near term to open up space to bring in a transfer or two that can help you. But also in the future, like, those 6 guys aren't sticking around. A third of them are going to transfer out at least. And the ones that transfer are the ones that aren't going to the NBA draft a year from now.
Connor Klingon out of UConn actually just announced also he's going to be heading to the draft as well.
Not a surprise.
Nobody's surprised by that.
Because 2 national championships, great player. Now's the time to go. Number 2 on the Big 4 is...
Let's get a Masters update.
Oh, by the way.
Shall we?
On the basketball note, we haven't forgotten about Kentucky. We're going to talk about Kentucky.
Yes, we are.
In just a little bit, because they got their coach. And
yeah, we'll get to that. Wow. You really like this hire, don't you?
Oh, I do. I love it so much. What is number 2?
In that Masters update, we just saw Tiger Woods setting the record. Consecutive cuts at the Masters with 24. Now, we have had some reshuffling at the top of the leaderboard. Max Homa, 6 under through 17 so far. He currently leads it now. 6 under, Bryson DeChambeau still. Scottie Scheffler still 6
whoa.
Under.
So is Homa just tied with those guys?
Well,
is it co-lead situation?
Okay, so it's co-leads. It's co-leads.
All right.
Yeah, but in the scoreboard, they got them up top, but I guess they're all tied anyway.
WD, just read the scoreboard.
Oh, actually, it just changed. Literally at this very second, Bryson DeChambeau, 7 under now as he now reclaims the lead.
Okay.
See?
I'm just trying to understand your updates.
Learning to read golf scorecards.
We're getting there.
We are.
But take the coaching. Let's be coachable.
I do.
On air. Coachable. Yes. That's what we are. Apparently the Deeks went up 4-0. That has not updated on my screen yet, but according to a reliable source, maybe the YouTube chat.
Yep.
That the Deeks lead Boston College 4-0 right
Boston
now.
College?
Not a bad thing. What is number 1 on the Big 4? Presented by
Budget blinds. The Bears aren't only taking over snacks. They're trying to take over the police department.
Ooh.
Yeah. Oddly enough, probably not oddly, this takes place in Florida. This was the Highway Patrol posted this security camera footage showing a hungry bear attempting to break into a parked patrol car. And here we go again with them posting something with the caption on Instagram saying, "Furry suspect who is wanted for attempted burglary of a state patrol car." Apparently, this bear has been hunting for snacks. He approached his car and attempted to use its mouth and paws to get at the door handle. And apparently, this bear's nickname is Teddy, as it should be. It was ultimately unsuccessful, though, trying to break in this thing, as the doors were, you know, it's a patrol car. It's going to be tough to get in that. They were locked at the time, and wildlife officials, they recommend keeping doors locked, especially if you're parked on the street. So,
yeah, how are you when it comes to locking things up? Sarah Bradford gets mad at me all the time because we walk into a restaurant and I leave my car unlocked.
Oh, I don't do that.
What, you don't keep your car unlocked? Or
no. Well, I always lock my car.
That's going to be your grand prize that you get in my car. And if I have something valuable in the car, I'll lock it up. But
I guess
not all the time. Like, is my car locked right now? I'm not inviting people to come by the studio and take my killer CDs if you want to. But no, it's not. Am I the weird one? In Canada, nobody locks up their stuff. They don't lock up houses.
They don't.
Their cars. Trustworthy type of people, and for good reason.
Yeah, I agree.
I used to leave my house unlocked.
Like, you would leave it and just leave it unlocked?
Yeah.
I
used to do that.
Yeah.
I don't do that anymore.
I'm sure Sarah Bradford wouldn't care too much for that.
Yeah, she would not. Or she would care if I left stuff unlocked. But you should know, I changed that behavior before I met Sarah Bradford, but it wasn't because I got burned or anything like that. Just was something that became part of the habit.
I see.
But you're a guy who locks up everything.
I lock up. Now, I will say, when I'm at home, I tend to leave my car unlocked.
Overnight?
Not overnight, but like if it's during the day and like I'm maybe going to leave again, or if I know I'll leave it unlocked. But no, overnight I lock it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Got it. I'm just saying, I recognize that I'm probably the weird one here.
Good chance.
Mm-hmm. Little bit of self-awareness in that regard. Keep it simple. A little bit later on, we've got Hayes Permars going to drop by. Coming up, though, local ties to the Bluegrass State hires. Plus, another world-class call by our guy, Kevin Harlan. Keep it here on a Friday drive.
A tradition unlike any other.
Thread the drive down between the majestic pines, down towards the left edge of that right bunker.
A week where good is just not good enough.
Avoid the left because it rolls down into the little stream down there in the pine straw.
From the dogwoods to the dog lakes. It's time to bring your best.
That is the 21st hole in one of the 16th. Bryson DeChambeau.
WSJS is proud to bring you updates of the 88th Masters. We'll deliver updates twice an hour, and we'll recap the day with the Masters tonight at 10 p.m.
320 would be a great shot, leaving an opening to the green.
All made possible by Jason's Deli of Winston-Salem. It's a family thing. YMCA of Northwest North Carolina. By Ace, the place with the helpful hardware folks on Robin Hood Road.
Left to right wind, working it back. So there we go. Very good.
And WSJS.
Here come Rock and Roll Hall of Famers. Frankie Valli and the Four Seasons. The Last Encore. Saturday, August 17th, Stephen Tanger Center for the Performing Arts. Frankie Valli and the Four Seasons. Tickets on sale now at the box office or at Ticketmaster.com. Don't miss Frankie Valli and the Four Seasons. Produced by NS2.
The Winston-Salem Fairgrounds, your one-stop source for entertainment in Winston-Salem. There's always something going on.
Pleasure at the fairground on the way.
Buy local, buy fresh at the Fairgrounds Farmers Market every Saturday from 6 a.m. till 12 noon. And that's year-round. And get ready for the summer concert series. For upcoming events, go to WSFairgrounds.com. The Winston-Salem Fairgrounds, your one-stop source for entertainment in Winston-Salem. WSFairgrounds.com.
Do you know the secret to losing up to 1 pound of fat every day?
Hi, this is Dr. Darcy Ward, D.C. with Winston Weight Loss, and I know the secret. Our unique weight loss program makes it easy to lose weight, get healthy, and get your energy back naturally, safely, and effectively. For your free consultation, go to WinstonWeightLoss.com.
Folks, don't wait another day. Let's lose the weight together. Your first step is to get in touch with the folks at Winston Weight Loss. The number is 336-800-3841. That's 336-800-3841. Or check them out online at WinstonWeightLoss.com. Discover how you too can lose up to a pound of fat every single day. I've lost more than 50 pounds. You can do it too.
With Winston Weight Loss, there's no counting points or calories. No exercising, no prepackaged meals, no drugs, no surgery, and no injections with the risk of serious side effects. Many patients lose 20 to 30 pounds in about a month or two. For your free consultation, go to WinstonWeightLoss.com. That's WinstonWeightLoss.com.
Results may vary.
There are a lot of so-called sports talk guys who don't do anything but flap their gums.
Yeah, exactly.
But not Josh Graham. He doesn't even like gum or flapping, for that matter.
He's so talented.
You're on The Drive with Josh Graham.
Both Louisville and Kentucky have now hired former Wake Forest assistants to be their head coach. Pat Kelsey was on Skip Prosser's staff once upon a time, now the head coach of the Cardinals. And Kentucky, we learned last night, hiring one of their own, Mark Pope, to be their next coach, coming from BYU. Mark Pope, though, a dozen years ago or so, was on Jeff Bezdelic's first staff at Wake Forest. So the Deacs, with some ties to those candidates. Another fun fact about Mark Pope: apparently among active men's basketball coaches, he is the biggest Swiftie out there. He gave Matt Norlander of CBS, when Matt Norlander asked every coach that made the tournament for his favorite artist, not only gave him Taylor Swift, gave Mark, or Matt, excuse me, his five favorite Taylor Swift songs.
Number five,
Cruel Summer.
Number four,
All Too Well, specifically the 10-minute version.
Number three,
Karma.
Number two,
New Year's Day. I don't even know what that is.
Number one,
Cornelia Street, on the Lover album. Underrated song. Speaking of Taylor Swift albums, the new Swift album drops a week from today. Am I excited? You bet I am. Is Travis Kelce excited? He certainly is. Today, he finally got a degree from his alma mater, the University of Cincinnati, and walked on stage, full gown and all, pounded a beer after being handed his diploma, while all the professors and, you know, luminaries at the university looked on proudly at their newest alum, Travis Kelce. Getting to the hire of Mark Pope, it reveals a disconnect between Kentucky's leadership and the crazy fan base that they have. AD Mitch Barnhart, likely thought this was going to be popular. He's a player, a captain from the 96 title team. I believe they called themselves the Untouchables with Rick Pitino as the coach. Surely the fan base will love one of their own. That fan base, however, rather would have the coach of that team, Mark Pope's coach, Rick Pitino, rather than having Mark Pope. Matt Jones, our guy, leading the charge and voicing disappointment among Kentucky fans today. This is the part that is nuts to me. The crazy piece of Mark Pope's resume is that he lacks an NCAA tournament win. They are replacing John Calipari, a Naismith Basketball Hall of Famer, with a coach that has not won an NCAA tournament game. That's why Cal's not at Kentucky anymore. Cal's not there because he never won in March. Or in recent years, he wasn't winning in March. He did, of course, a while back, but didn't escape the Sweet 16 in the last 5 years. Or didn't get to the Sweet 16, excuse me, in the last 5 years. Didn't get to the Final Four since 2015. Haven't won a title since 2012. So that was the reason why Cal pulled the chute on his way to Arkansas. And now you're going to hire a guy who has never won an NCAA tournament game? Do you know the last time Kentucky had a coach, hired a coach, I should say, that did not have an NCAA tournament win? Adolph Rupp. That's also the last time Kentucky had a coach that did not have an NCAA tournament win. Why? Because Adolph Rupp started coaching at Kentucky in 1930. The NCAA tournament didn't exist until 1939. So ever since there's been an NCAA tournament, Kentucky's had coaches that have won tournament games. Seven hires since Adolph Rupp. All seven of those six of the first seven have NCAA tournament wins prior to arriving on campus in Lexington. Mark Pope is the exception of that, but it falls in line with what Duke and Carolina have done. Hiring coaches that are in air quotes the family of the program and hiring alumni that aren't as proven but understand the environment, understand the culture. But the lack of patience here by Kentucky AD Mitch Barnhart, that's the foolish piece. There's no way Billy Donovan turned him down already. He's focused on his Chicago Bulls season that ends in the next week, play-in tournament. We'll see what happens. But if you're Kentucky, why are you in a rush whatsoever? You're Kentucky. It's like Alabama. Oh, the job came free the week after or the day after the national championship game or around that point. Okay, well, Nick Saban's going to have, they're going to have no problem finding their successor in Tuscaloosa, regardless of what month out of the year it is. And they found Kalen DeBoer, who had just made the college football playoff. Like, there really isn't a rush for Kentucky making a hire this week versus making them next week. So the fact that they didn't even really strongly consider Billy Donovan by expressing some level or showcasing some level of patience, that's the piece that seems foolish to me, and it reveals a disconnect between Kentucky's AD, maybe their university president, and those bat bleep crazy fans that they have in the bluegrass. The NBA playoffs are nearing. It's the final weekend of the regular season. Kevin Harlan, he's ready for the playoffs. Here he was having another Kevin Harlan-like moment on the Sacramento-New Orleans game on TNT.
Pelicans hold on, driving into Murray. Somebody's throwing something on the floor. 46 seconds to go and a whistle blew. It's a chicken wing. Why would someone throw something that good out on the floor? It's crispy. Yes. It's warm.
Yes.
And I almost had to go out. I'm so hungry.
I hear your stomach over here growling.
What's that guy? I hope he eats it.
Kevin Harlan.
Wow.
We learned a lot from him there. We know that he has a big appetite based on that clip that you just heard, his reaction to being reminded of how good Angus Barn is.
And eating steaks the size of his head.
We need to go to Angus Barn with Kevin Harlan.
Can we do a remote for that?
Let's try to do that when he gets into town for the NSMA. I know it's in Raleigh, but I just want to hear his reaction again to having that.
Enjoying that meal.
Yeah. Kevin, couple questions arise from this clip. Kevin clearly does not subscribe to the 5-second rule.
No.
Does not? He's like, I hope this guy eats this wing that was thrown out there. How do you know it's crispy? Do you have that type of vision that you can see that the wing is crispy? Maybe. How do you know it's warm, though, Kevin? You don't know that.
Just painting a picture here.
You might be doing that, but I question your credibility, Kevin Harlan, by saying that that wing, you have no way to know that how warm that wing is. No way. What's your policy on stuff falling down? Do you eat it or not?
Typically, I try not to drop it in the first place. But...
Oh, wow. What a take.
I mean, it depends on what it is.
If I paid for something and I drop it, I'm eating it.
It depends on what floor it is.
I remember I dropped, or I was driving my car and I had Chick-fil-A in the passenger seat and I spilled the Chick-fil-A onto the floor mat of my car.
Mm-hmm.
I put the fries back in the bag and I ate the bag, or I ate the fries in the bag. Why? Because I paid for that.
I get it.
And I'm eating what I paid
for. And that's a tricky circumstance. I mean, listen, if I drop something like a chicken wing that has a sauce that can pick up things because it's like a stickier, you know, it's a sauce. You can get things on it, like hairs and
sure
things that are on the floor.
But I'm can see if there's hair on it.
I'm still not eating that. Now, okay. If it's like a chip or a dry food like that, like a snack food, and it's 5 seconds, I'll pick it up, eat it. Especially if it's like my kitchen floor. Yeah, because it's, yeah.
My reaction to that take.
Wow.
The NBA playoffs. Here's what's been decided. We only have one first round matchup set already. Just one. That is Mavs Clippers in a 4-5 game in the West. 4-5 series in the West. We do have an elimination play-in game matchup set. The Bulls will face the Hawks in a 9-10 to decide who plays the loser of the 7-8 for the final, eighth and final spot in the Eastern Conference playoffs. The number one seed in the West, that's still up for grabs. You got three teams in contention for that. The Nuggets, a one-game lead over Minnesota and Oklahoma City. It'd be cool if either of the latter get the top seed in the West, the Thunder or the T-Wolves. The final play-in team for the East is uncertain. Not on the back end, because we just told you 9-10, that's set, but will it be the Sixers, the Magic, or the Pacers that play in that 7-8 game? Right now, it'd be Philly if the season ended today, but Philly tonight plays the Orlando Magic in the city of brotherly love. You've got the Pacers facing the Cleveland Cavaliers tonight, which is a fun matchup. So there's still so much to have figured out on the NBA playoff ledger, which is fun going into the final weekend. To recap the week in the most efficient way possible, we keep it simple. Next on The Drive.
From the Augusta National Golf Club, Westwood One Sports presents this special report on the Masters. I'm Ted Emmerich. More history from a man who has made plenty of it.
At 18, Tiger Woods for a closing par. Putter back on its way, and he's made it. What a round of golf that was from Tiger Woods. He gets some applause from the patrons and in the booth here from Steve Melnick. Tiger has made the cut for a 24th consecutive year, a Masters record. And the five-time Masters champion hears it from the patrons gathered around the 18th green.
Taylor Zarzer, the call on Sirius XM. We're all just normal men compared to Tiger. He has barely played in the last calendar year, and yet he'll play the weekend here at Augusta National. Woods 9 back of the leader, Bryson DeChambeau, who is 8 under. You're listening to coverage of the 2024 Masters on Westwood One.
Now. Now your ideas don't have to wait. Now they have everything they need to come to life. Dell Technologies and Intel are creating technology that loves ideas, loves expanding your business, evolving your passions. We push what technology can do, so great ideas can happen right now. Find out how to bring your ideas to life at Dell.com. Welcome to now.
Without the ones like you, who work tirelessly to keep things running, everything would suddenly stop. Hospitals, factories, schools, and power plants, they all depend on you. No matter the weather, emergency, or time of day, you're the ones who get it done. At Grainger, we're here for you with professional-grade industrial supplies. Count on real-time product availability and fast delivery. Call, click Grainger.com, or just stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
Bryson DeChambeau's foot is on the gas in Amen Corner. Let's check the leaderboard, sponsored by Dell. Dell Technologies pushes what technology can do, so your great ideas can happen right now. Learn more at Dell.com. DeChambeau opening up a two-shot lead with birdies at 12 and 13. He is 8 under. Max Homa, 6 under par, 2 back. A 171 today for Homa, who wore robin egg blue pants, played alongside Tiger Woods these last 2 days. Scottie Scheffler didn't have a single bogey through 22 holes this week. Well, now 2 in the last 3 holes at 5 and 7. Scheffler dropping to 5 under. That's 3 off the pace. Nikolai Højgaard and Danny Willett, 4 under, 4 back. Højgaard with a 1 over 73 today. Willett even through 15. Cameron Davis, the only player at 3 under. That's 5 back. Ludvig Åberg, 2 under, 6 back. Round of the day with a 3 under 69. From Augusta, I'm Ted Emmerich, Westwood One Sports.
You're on the drive with Josh Graham, WSJS.
The Carolina Cobras are at home this weekend. Get some tickets online. We'll make it easy for you. Go to WSJS.com, click on the Carolina Cobras. You'll go directly to their website. And there you could also see their merchandise, from hats, jerseys, hoodies, sweatshirts, tank tops. Support the Triads Professional Arena Football League team. That is the Carolina Cobras, Greensboro Coliseum. They'll be playing this weekend. WD, not to get political around here. I'm not proud of this feeling, but when I see people talk about erasing student debt, for example, the first thing I think in my head is, well, how about you credit the people who did pay for their school first? You know, I had to do that, and now you guys are getting a gift. That's not the selfish part of my being that I'm not proud of surfaces when that conversation comes up. And similarly, I asked for Apple TV logins, and I got a few texts, and I think we're taken care of. But I spend a hefty sum to watch my Orioles all year long. Got to invest in the VPN market. Mm-hmm. They think I'm in New Jersey, so I can watch the Orioles play day in and day out. The MLB package isn't cheap. And then WD just sheepishly comes in on my coattails as I'm talking about Apple TV and says, you know, I could use a login to watch the Yankees, maybe, possibly too. And then while we're trying to do a show, in fact, I'm like calling for clips and things of that nature.
You're and you on the got them.
You're on the phone.
And you got them because
I'm
good
at it. And
you're
writing things down. And why? What were you doing as we're trying to do a show?
Shout out to Brad, who called in and gave me the login for his MLB TV account.
Yeah, thanks, Brad. Very nice of you, Brad.
All I had to do was ask.
Brad, very nice. Is he a Yankee fan?
I have no idea.
I hope so. To do something nice for a Yankee fan. Incredible. Let's recap the week in the most efficient way possible by Keep It Simple.
Five words or less.
It's simple, man.
That's all Josh gets to tell you where your favorite teams are at.
It's as marvelous and as simple as that.
Let's keep it simple.
Okay, for those uninitiated, we like to picture this segment as if we're hanging out in the club. Got the music going. It's 4:30 in the afternoon on this Friday. So before WD throws some topics at me that I'll recap in five words or less, we see who's in this club with a dance break.
Wow. Here we go.
Now, I met with the team. There is no team.
Falcons go on vacations like we are.
Merry Christmas, everybody.
Let's go to the sidelines. Tony Haynes.
The John Calipari clip kills me.
Now, met with the team.
There is no team.
Oh. NC State losing in the Final Four.
The loss doesn't diminish anything. They have a big sign at the Final Four that means a lot to coaches and players. Big sign on the arena that they play in the football stadium that reads, "The road ends here." And if you see that sign and you're still playing basketball, it doesn't matter if you lose in the semifinal or in the championship game or if you cut down nets. You're a champion. You're a champion for getting to that stage. If you don't understand that, then that's a you problem. State's going to hang banners, plural, based on what they did, and they should. And losing to Purdue, there's no shame in that, even though they had their opportunities.
UConn, back-to-back titles, this one over Purdue.
An all-time championship team. My buddy Joe Giglio got upset with me saying, you know, stick to the lakes and oceans that you know, citing my age, saying, I'm just a youngin'. How are you going to say they're top three among teams? And we were using a sample since 1985 when the tournament expanded. And I truly believe, even as a student of history of those 80s and 90s teams, that this UConn team, I wouldn't say they're better than 01 Duke or 2009 UNC, but I'll put them up against 92 Duke and UNLV in 1990 and against Kentucky in 2012. I think they're that dominant when you talk about 22 points per win during this tournament on average. After a year ago, they were at 18 points per win. Just sheer dominance by the Huskies.
Let's get to that John Calipari guy. John Calipari leaving Kentucky for Arkansas.
It's best for both parties. Really for all three parties, but we'll just limit it to Kentucky and Arkansas here. Arkansas gets an upgrade as their head coach in a Hall of Famer that's going to move the needle for Hogs basketball. That hasn't been in that place since Nolan Richardson was a national contender in the 90s. Kentucky gets the turn to page and do so without paying a $33 million buyout, because really this is what everybody wanted after losing to Oakland, losing a bad first round tournament game for the second time in 3 years and not getting out of the first weekend for 5 years. It was time for both parties. This is good for Cal. This is good for Arkansas. This is good for Kentucky.
The passing of O.J. Simpson.
The most infamous American life. Infamous sounds like a better word than significant, because some always take significant to mean positive. But if you want to talk about just how many different borders, areas of culture this guy has crossed over into, I don't think there's anybody like it in modern history. When you consider the sports element of it, the television element, movie element, racial element, the legal crime element, he checks all the boxes of being such a fascinating figure, one of the more fascinating figures in public life and American culture in the 20th in 21st century.
The debut of Jackson Holliday. Can't leave that out.
The birds have officially arrived. The baby birds with the milkman, Colton Cowser, hitting a couple of bombs last night. Holy Cowser! And Jackson Holliday, I might get a jersey. That might happen. I am so excited to be an Oriole fan. How excited? I've been wearing Orioles gear every day this week. It's what we're about around here. Birds. Went for the sweep in Boston. We'll see what they do tonight with Jackson Holliday's first home series against the Brewers. And that's it for Keep It Simple. One more dance break in order.
In your life, have you seen anything like that?
Oh! What just happened?
It's crispy. Yes. It's warm.
Yes.
Fried chicken and beer.
Wow.
What's up, Bob Costas? We didn't have beer because we're on the clock, but WD finally did get his bet paid off. We went to Putters. Couldn't think of a better place to watch some of the Masters at than Putters in Winston-Salem. They're not paying us to say that. They should.
Yeah, can.
We appreciate them. Make it happen. But finally paid off the Bachelor bet, which bummed me out. Make sure you're subscribed to the Best Of.
And now we go back to the Masters. Speaking of what we were watching at Putters, Bryson DeChambeau still leading the way, now by 2 strokes, as he's 8-under through 13.
I haven't even seen his 8-under putt. Wow.
Well, rest assured, he hit it. Max Homa, he's finished for the day, 6-under now. Scotty Scheffler, he's in the third position. 5-under par.
6.
Yours updated faster than mine did?
No, I think you actually got that right. Mine's not updating as fast.
Oh, I see. Can't believe you messed up my update like that.
Sorry. I also don't see where you see DeChambeau is at 8-under. The television and my screen are telling me 7-under.
Is either he, your TV is behind.
What
or,
hole? What's he through?
13.
Well, I'm ahead of you then, because he's through 14. He's at 7.
I see that.
And Scheffler's through 8, and he's 6-under.
Yeah.
So you're not updated. What screen are you looking at?
The scoreboard.
Maybe hit the refresh button.
I did.
See what happens. See how factual.
It's still the same. So, hey, PGAtour.com, get on it.
Get on ESPN.com.
You made me say fake news.
Yeah. WD is so bad at it, it's entertaining. It's unbelievable.
It's been fun. I've enjoyed
it. I have not. I'm glad you've enjoyed this.
Yeah.
So much. I have not enjoyed it so much. I'm also not enjoying the fact that the 3 guys that I picked, none of them are in red digits right now.
Oof.
Xander Schauffele, is it even par? The guys I picked for top 20s look pretty good, but Brooks Koepka, he's at 2-over. Don't even want to look where. I don't even remember who the 3rd guy I thought was going to win was. That I picked. Oh, John Rahm. Is he even going to make the cut? He's at 3-over. So,
ooh, wow.
Not great for last year's Masters champ. Before I was rudely interrupted, I was reminding you that you should be subscribed to the Best Of podcast. Search The Drive with Josh Graham, iTunes, Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and Anchor, because you might miss Jerry Haas, Wake Golf Coach, joining us as he did an hour ago. Or you might miss Hayes Permar playing skips or plays with Hayes with us an hour from now. Be sure to subscribe. And those downloads, it helps us. We appreciate that. And our YouTube channel has been blowing up. So be sure to jump in on that if you haven't as well. Search The Drive with Josh Graham on YouTube. That's where we're streaming video of the show. Luck right now. Up next, Cam Newton said what? You're locked in to a Rhinestone Cowboy Friday Drive.
Wherever you go, you can take us along. Listen to our live stream at WSJS.com and never miss a thing. Listen in an Uber. Listen in your favorite restroom stall. Listen when you're making fudge. And we know how much you love fudge. Wherever you go, like Stonehenge, take us along. Listen to our live stream at WSJS.com. No need for an app. Just type in WSJS.com and click on Listen Live.
Riddle Tractor sells the good stuff. Skag Residential and Commercial Mowers will create and maintain the perfect lawn and landscape. Skag mowers are created to be tougher than anything you can throw at it and built for superior durability, productivity, and comfort. At Riddle Tractor, we sell the good stuff. Tractors, mowers, blowers, and more at Riddle Tractor in Winston-Salem, equipping those who get the job done. For more information, visit RiddleTractor.com.
City Barbecue's motto is slow and low, baby. Their pitmasters use hickory, years of experience, and all 24 hours to craft the city's best barbecue. Pulled pork, tender beef, brisket, all off the bone ribs, juicy smoked chicken, turkey, and sausage. City Barbecue's selection of sauces is awesome. Pick your favorite region and sauce up your barbecue. And don't get me started on their made-from-scratch fixins and desserts. Go to City Barbecue today on Jonestown Road in Winston-Salem. Slow and low, baby. Slow and low.
Merlefest 2024, presented by Window World, delivers music, moments, and memories each year. Join the fun to hear Old Crow Medicine Show, Turnpike Troubadours, the Teskey Brothers, Nickel Creek, Molly Tuttle and Golden Highway, Larkin Poe, Lucas Nelson, Steep Canyon Rangers, the Dan Tomiski Band, Bela Fleck, My Bluegrass Heart, Sam Bush, Jerry Douglas, the Earls of Leicester, Sierra Hull, Brandy Clark, Nick Shoulders, Willie Watson, and more. Join us April 25th to the 28th in Wilkesboro, North Carolina. For tickets, visit merlefest.org.
Tune in to Preserve Your Wealth with Jules Harris.
What does matter, though, is do you have enough income to support your lifestyle, keep your lifestyle the same?
Your retirement matters.
And the savings plan is equally as important as everything else you have in your retirement plan. And if you haven't saved enough, then you have to up the ante on your savings plan.
Tune in to Preserve Your Wealth with Jules Harris, Saturdays at 10 a.m. right here on WSJS News Talk Sports for the Triad.
Josh Graham loves to talk sports. He also loves to take herbal body baths to keep his skin supple and youthful looking. You're on the Drive with Josh Graham.
We'll circle back to the Masters in just a few minutes, get into some of the big storylines heading into the weekend. But first, Cam Newton still seems bitter about being let go by the Panthers years ago. Because while he was sitting down with Shannon Sharp for a podcast, there was a revisionist history that he presented that was misleading and pretty honestly reckless when the topic of how the Panthers rebuilt that year came up, how they pressed the reset button. He begins by suggesting that it was a mistake to go into the rebuild in the first place.
We have to start holding these people in management accountable. You should not have cleaned house like you cleaned your house. Getting rid of a Ryan Khalil impacted that offensive line. Getting rid of a Thomas Davis impacted that defense, not just the linebackers. Losing Luke, how you lost Luke.
A couple of things here. People need to be held accountable in leadership. Who at that time was not held accountable? David Tepper's been painted as the worst owner in the NFL by some, now that Dan Schneider's not around anymore. Marty Herney let go. Scott Fitterer, who replaced him, let go. Who's not been held accountable? Who's Cam talking about there? Ryan Khalil? He said going into that season that he was going to retire at the end of the year. We knew that it was going to be his last game as a Panther, the final game he played in New Orleans. And then the next offseason ended and training camp began, Ryan Khalil had that itch and he decided, I still want to play football. And the Panthers had a center at that point, so he played for the Jets. Thomas Davis, moving off of him was not a mistake. This reminds me of Aaron Rodgers before his final season in Green Bay, talking about all the mistakes that management made in his mind and that it wasn't considered for. They moved off of Jordy Nelson and moved off of all these veterans all the way down the line. And these veterans were washed. And this is why you can't have players serving to be your GM. That's why this has to be a separation there, because the players have these personal relationships where they're not going to believe a guy's ever washed. They're not going to cut their best friends and their teammates. They're not going to want to do that. It's the job of a GM to do unpopular, difficult things like moving off of popular people. It's part of the job. But Cam does not hit on the primary reason that they had to go into the rebuild, which was he couldn't stay healthy. The shoulder, which deteriorated in 2018 after the TJ Watt hit, 2019, the foot being such. If Cam doesn't get hurt, the Panthers probably make the playoffs in 2018. They win enough in 2019 that Ron Rivera doesn't lose his job. Cam doesn't leave just to return for a brief stint a couple of years later. None of that happens. That's why Carolina went into a rebuild. And if you agree with that, great. If you don't and hold Cam's opinion, that's fine too. That opinion is largely harmless. It's when he went on talking about Luke Kuechly that he crossed the line, in my opinion, to being reckless.
Luke retired, right? But I do think Luke would not have retired if he knew that locker room was still going to be intact. He probably would have took some time off, right? And his health isn't important, you know, taking concussions extremely serious. But that would have been something that you would have had to consider, being a Luke Kuechly, knowing that I still got KK Short, I still got Charles Johnson, I still got Thomas Davis, I still got guys that's gonna battle with me. You dig what I'm saying? Julius Peppers. They all left. And these are the things that he had to think back and say, hold on, we ain't got none of that. I gotta start over. Nah, I'm good with that.
This is reckless. He might have taken some time off. What? What is Cam talking about here? Julius Peppers, we knew he was retiring at the end of the 2019 season, too. It wasn't a mystery. It wasn't because of the rebuild. We just knew that that was going to happen. I don't remember people lobbying to keep KK Short and Charles Johnson around. Again, this goes back to Cam's buddies with these guys. They were on the 2015 team together. The reality of the NFL is you get old, and you get old quick in that sport. And you got to make decisions. And Carolina made some decisions. The rebuild was defensible. So was moving off of Cam. Cam wasn't a victim. The Panthers weren't wrong to go into a rebuild. They just hired the wrong coach. See, this kind of reminds me of what could happen with the Panthers trade last year. Some say, oh, the Panthers regret trading DJ Moore. Regret making that trade. No, they don't. There's a chance they regret the quarterback they took. But if they feel any regret with that, it's not going to be that they traded up. It's not the philosophy of trading up to that number one pick that they're going to regret. What they're going to regret is the quarterback they took with it. And the same's true of the rebuild. Carolina doesn't regret going into a rebuild. They might regret the coach that they decided to hire. Speaking of Bryce Young, Cam Newton shared some advice he had for Bryce. Again, this is courtesy of Shannon Sharpe's podcast.
Well, I remember having a conversation with a brief conversation with him during Super Bowl. I saw him at a party, and I think he needs to understand that voicing his opinion is important. Bryce has to obviously be open to doing it, not doing it publicly,
right?
Right. But doing it behind the scenes to say, listen, if we got this person in the draft, this is who I want.
Right.
That, like, I need to be protected.
And it does appear he's going to be with the investment of Damian Lewis, Robert Hunt, the two offensive guards that they brought in for $60 million plus guaranteed and $150 million combined in their total contracts. Cam Newton, though, the revisionist history piece. It's misleading. It's reckless. Getting to the Masters. Three storylines heading into the weekend of note. And it starts with the leader, Beefy Bryson DeChambeau. Bryson struggled in this tournament. And last year, for example, missed the cut. Now he's at 7-under, still alone at the top. Max Homa chasing, Scottie Scheffler chasing. That will be the dominant story going in after a couple of rounds. DeChambeau is on the par 3 16th currently. Do you trust? He had a lead at the U.S. Open in one of the great collapses in modern history we've seen in a major just a few years ago. Bryson DeChambeau, his composure and how he is able to close and deal with pressure, that is the first storyline. Then you got the top two players in the world, at least according to the World Golf Ranking. Scottie Scheffler, who is the heavy favorite going in, is right there, a shot back of Bryson DeChambeau. You might think that he is the type of guy. Oh, wait, DeChambeau put one into the water. And now he's dumped one into the stands. Oh, boy. We're already starting to see DeChambeau. You know, unravel a little bit here. As the first shot went into the water, and then he's back on the tee and put it into the patrons. We'll see how that shakes out when we get to the five things at five. But Scottie Scheffler, his wife, could go into labor any moment. And he's pretty much made it clear, regardless of where he is on the leaderboard, if that happens, he's leaving. So there's a chance, WD, he could be the leader and then have a kid and say, yep, I'm out. Sorry. Peace. That's it. I won it last year, or I won it 2 years ago. That's my priorities. They're in the right place. Sorry. Bye.
See, that would be a good story to tell to his child later in life. Like, listen, you think this person's parents is great? You know what I did for you? I was leading the Masters.
I'm thinking
and
of,
I walked.
I'm thinking of all the bad beats.
Oh my God.
Could you imagine you're leading and then he walks off the golf course in the in the final round? Guys, I gotta go. Sorry. And Rory McIlroy is still just kind of hanging in the weeds a little bit. Right where he wants him. He's at plus one, which still top 25 as of right now. So Rory in the mix, Tiger Woods at plus one, two. He makes the cut, sets that record, 24 straight years of making the cut. The Wake guys, that's the last storyline we're following. Will Zalatoris is plus two, finished plus two on the day. And, or actually, he's on 11. He's at plus two. Still has the rest of the course to go. Cam Young finished his round with a 73 today. He's minus one on the tournament. The five things at five open up our final hour of the week. Next.
From the Augusta National Golf Club, Westwood One Sports presents this special report on the Masters. I'm Ted Emmerich. A gritty performance from Tiger Woods, and he will play the weekend here at Augusta. Woods breaking the record with his 24th consecutive made cut at the Masters. Tiger battling to an even par 72 in the second round. He sits at one over for the tournament.
I'm right there. I'm only, what, eight back as of right now. I don't think anyone's going to run off and hide right now, but it's really bunched. The way the ball is moving on the greens, chip shots are being blown. It's all you wanted in a golf course today.
Yeah, gusts are reaching 40 miles an hour. At 18, as Woods lined up his par putt, the wind was blowing so hard it lifted the sand out of the bunker and tossed it at Tiger's face. He had to wait for it to calm down before stroking the putt. Bryson DeChambeau is the leader at 7-under. Again, Woods is 8 back. You're listening to coverage of the 2024 Masters on Westwood One.
Remembering great moments in golf history, sponsored by Prevagen, Prevagen is the most recommended memory support brand by pharmacists. Annika Sorenstam took women's golf by storm in 1995 by winning Rookie of the Year and the U.S. Open, but 1996 solidified her status among the game's elite. Sorenstam won her second consecutive U.S. Open by shooting a then-record 8 under par 272. Sorenstam would go on to win a total of 10 majors in her Hall of Fame career. With this great moment in golf history, I'm Kevin Kugler.
Traveling, volunteering, spending time with family? What's your retirement look like? With income planning from Fidelity Wealth Management, a dedicated advisor can help you grow and protect your wealth. They'll look at your full financial picture and help you create a flexible strategy that considers things like market conditions and healthcare expenses, so you can stop worrying about the future and enjoy whatever comes next. Visit fidelity.com/income planning. Investment minimums apply. Fidelity Brokerage Services member NYSE SIPC.
Let's check the second round leaderboard at the Masters. It's sponsored by Prevagen. Prevagen is the most recommended memory support brand by pharmacists. Bryson DeChambeau had a two-shot lead. It is back down to one after DeChambeau bogeyed 14. He's even par for the second round, 7 under overall, one shot better than Max Homa and Scottie Scheffler. Homa in the clubhouse, a 1 under 71 today. Homa has put up his best score 2 rounds into the Masters. This is his 5th career start at Augusta National. Scheffler making the turn now, even par today, 6 under overall. Scheffler, a couple of bogeys at 5 and 7, his first bogeys of the week. At 4 under par, Nikolai Højgaard, 1 over 73 today. Also, Danny Willett, even today as he plays 18. So, Højgaard and Willett are 3 back. From Augusta, I'm Ted Emmerich, Westwood One Sports.
The Triads News Talk and Sports Station. WSJS Winston-Salem, Greensboro, High Point, Burlington. Online at WSJS.com.
The Drive with Josh Graham, only on WSJS.
It's time for the 5 Things at 5.
All right, people, take 5.
Brought to you by Precision Garage Door, where their 5 things are great service, dependable service, superior service, friendly service, and fast service. Here are the top 5 stories trending now.
Yes, the 5 Things at 5 are presented by Precision Garage Door online, precisiondoornc.com. That's where you can go and book an appointment. Longtime sponsors of this segment, this show, this station, and it is greatly appreciated. Support the people that support us. Again, precisiondoornc.com if you have any garage door issues.
Number 5.
The Atlanta Braves will see a welcome opponent tonight. They were drilled by the New York Mets yesterday at home. Who do they get tonight? The 2-win Miami Marlins. The Yankees lost to the Marlins, by the way, a couple of days ago. Just throwing that out there. They're 2-11, I think, the Marlins are. Something around that. The Braves should be in good shape there. My Baltimore Orioles face the Milwaukee Brewers tonight. Got my Apple TV Plus login. I'm ready to go.
Yeah, I'm ready too. I got my MLB TV ready.
Is your team even playing?
No, it's postponed, but it's ready when they are.
To win. They're not playing today?
No, I think they're going to make that one on tomorrow.
Okay, well, tomorrow. You don't get to watch your baseball team today. That's all I got to say about that. Forrest Gump. That movie never gets old. No. It's one of those movies that you could just throw on at any point. That sequence might be my favorite sequence of the movie, where Jenny runs into the water and they meet. But also, that's all I got to say about that. And he's the Forrest Gump. And
I do like that one.
And that's also when he confronts the guy at the Black Panther party. Yeah. And you have Forrest says, "I'm sorry, I ruined your Black Panther party." And is it offensive to do the Forrest Gump voice? I don't think it is.
No, he's just a character.
Just making sure. Just checking things here. And then you have it caps with the confrontation at the bus, where he tells the guy where he and Jenny are from, which is Greenbow, Alabama. Might be the best part of the movie. How did
Number
we get
4
on Forrest Gump? I don't know, but I appreciate you keeping us on track, keeping the train on the track, so to speak. We have 1 more hour until we call it a weekend to watch the Masters and company. The Masters in just a bit. The Charlotte Hornets season ends this weekend. They have 2 more games, starting with tonight. at the Boston Celtics. The Celtics lost last night.
Boston
at home to the Knicks. Means I probably don't like the Charlotte Hornets' chances tonight. I don't like the chances at Cleveland either. They're probably going to finish the season 20-62, but at least you had that come-from-behind win on Wednesday night.
What just happened?
Brandon Miller averages 20 points per game, has averaged 20 points per game since February, right on the dot. I think it's 20.03 points per game. So let's see if he can finish the season strong and over the last 2.5 months of the year finish with a 20-point average. He's averaging 23 over the last five. We'll see how he fares later on tonight. His over 18.5 points is one of the best bets that we handed out for tonight, in addition to the Magic plus 7.5 in a key game against the Sixers for playoff positioning and trying to avoid the play-in tournament.
Number three.
The door has been left open by the New York Rangers in the Metro Division. The Carolina Hurricanes The Canes have an opportunity to walk through that door. They are 3 points down of the Rangers. You get 2 points for a win, one for an overtime loss, none for a loss, obviously. 3 points down with three games to go. The Rangers only have two games left because they lost last night to the Flyers, so Carolina has a game in hand. Unless the Rangers lose their last two games at home, which they're probably not going to do, this is what needs to happen. You need the Rangers to lose one more time, and it needs to be, and they can't have the second game go to overtime. You can't have them get any more points, I don't think. And, well, actually, it won't matter if they get a point. Let them have a point. That's fine. Carolina is going to have to win their remaining three games. Now, there is a scenario that they lose both their games, and one goes to overtime and Carolina wins two of their last three. Nah, that'd still have you in a tie. If the Rangers get as much as a point in their last two games, Carolina's going to have to win their last three. If they lose one out of the two and you win all three, then you win the Metro Division. You're following here. Canes are at St. Louis tonight. That's your biggest challenge. If they get past tonight, they should beat Chicago and Columbus, who are both horrific in the last two games of the year. So that's it. Win tonight and then have the Rangers lose one more game, and you might be talking about the fourth straight Metro Division title for Carolina. The playoffs are approaching for both the NBA and the NHL. If the Canes don't win the Metro, they likely have the New York Islanders in round one of the playoffs. If they do win the division, it'll either be Washington or Philadelphia.
Number two.
Bryson DeChambeau ran into some trouble on 16, but with an amazing chip at the hole from the fringe, he's able to save par and retain that 7-under score and the lead at the Masters that is now a co-lead due to an incredible putt by Scottie Scheffler to get to 7-under par. That's where things stand at the moment. 7-under for Scotty, 7-under for Bryson DeChambeau, and Max Homa is at 6-under already in the clubhouse, carding a second round 71. That's when you have the drop-off where you get into a group of two at 4-under, another pair at 3-under, a pair after that at 2-under, and then massive globs at 1-under par and at even par. There are, let me do the math here real quickly. There are 9 golfers that are at 2-under par or better. That's the group that you should have circled as being champions for this tournament.
9 times.
So Adberg, Fitzpatrick, Cam Davis, Morikawa, Willett, Hogard, nailed it, Homa, Scheffler, DeChambeau, those are the guys you should be looking at as your next major champion, your next Masters champion.
Number one.
The number one story. We'll get back to the Tiger Woods side of things today in just a bit. But the number one story on the Five Things at Five, brought to you by Precision Garage Door. My cousin is Kato Chow. You don't know what that's from?
No.
Anchorman.
Oh, that's yeah.
The name
oh,
of the
yeah.
bear that became friends with. Come on now. I don't know why you were laughing at that if you didn't get the joke.
Well, it's funny.
Is it Kato Chow or Kato Pow?
I don't remember.
The cousin that Baxter befriended to fend off the mother bear
yeah.
and the other bears after the bear fight at the San Diego Zoo at the end of Anchorman. Today we spell redemption, R-O-N. Why am I telling you this? Again, this has been a little wonky. We started with Forrest Gump. Now we ended up Forrest Gump. And now we're ending with Anchorman, maybe two of the most quotable movies of the last 30 years. Well, in Japan, they have a thing called an environment ministry. And that environment ministry is warning that hungry bears may return to human communities in the spring after hibernating. And what will those hungry bears do? Attack people. You hear that, Ed? Bears. Now you're putting the whole station in danger. At a meeting at related ministries and agencies yesterday, the ministry said that it would send a notice to offices as early as in late April, alerting them that bears coming out of their winter sleep could be dangerous. This was held in response to a record number of human casualties from bears in the last fiscal year, bears attacks. What are those numbers? Six peoples were killed by bears nationwide, including the injured. The total number of victims was 219. It's about 70% more than where it was for the previous fiscal year. Bears, Ed. You hear that? Bears. Hey, bear. I don't know if that works for hungry bears.
I don't know. That's a tricky one, because that's when they're the most aggressive, as we know.
I'm sure Willow the dog would befriend a bear to
you
rescue
think she
us.
Would?
Yeah, just like Baxter. Baxter resilient. Punted off a bridge by Jack Black and then made friends with bears. Saved the day. If you're talking about all-time movie pets, that bear, or pardon me, the Baxter's in the conversation. Along with the dog from Anatomy of the Fall this year, which was great. The dog from The Pianist, excellent. Trying to think of other great movie animals.
Old Yeller.
The horse from War Horse. Pretty darn good. Yeah.
Old Yeller. Good one.
Got the job done. For sure.
My name is Forrest Gump.
Forrest Gump.
That'll never stop making me laugh.
So.
Whenever that movie comes up, you should know that. Just isolate that one part.
Yeah.
All I think about in my head, anytime someone brings up that movie, this is what triggers in my head.
Forrest Gump.
It's been a busy 24 hours. 336-777-1600 if you want in on the show. What I was saying is it's been a busy 24 hours for Duke basketball. A lot of decisions having been made over the last 24 hours. But has it been a good day? Huh? Are we going to the phones real quickly? We can get to phones later. But we get to Duke basketball and then Hayes Permar next on The Drive.
A tradition unlike any other.
Thread the drive down between the majestic pines, down towards the left edge of that right bunker.
A week where good is just not good enough.
Avoid the left because it rolls down into the little stream down there in the pine straw.
From the dogwoods to the doglegs, it's time to bring your best.
That is the 21st hole-in-one of the 16th. Bryson DeChambeau.
WSJS is proud to bring you updates of the 88th Masters. We'll deliver updates twice an hour, and we'll recap the day with the Masters tonight at 10 p.m.
320 would be a great shot, leaving an opening to the green.
All made possible by Jason's Deli of Winston-Salem. It's a family thing. YMCA of Northwest North Carolina. By Ace, the place with the helpful hardware folks on Robin Hood Road.
Left to right wind, working it back. So there we go. Very good.
And WSJS.
The Carolina Cobras, the Triads Arena football team, return to the Snake Pit at the Greensboro Coliseum this Sunday. The Cobras look to declaw the Peach State Cats. Call 336-455-7232 to get your season tickets now. Or slither on over to CarolinaCobras.com to get your tickets today. That's CarolinaCobras.com. And fear the fans.
The Y, where membership means more than fitness. It means you belong. As a member of the Y, you're a part of the transformative work they do to strengthen community. They offer memberships that help you connect with your community and achieve your goals. Belong to more than a gym. Belong to the YMCA. To learn more about ongoing personal training promotions, registration for swim lessons, and to sign up for t-ball, basketball, and summer sports camp, visit YMCANWNC.org. That's YMCANWNC.org.
Get to Crossroads Ford of Kernersville today. You guys asked for rebates and they listened. Crossroads Ford is offering the largest rebates they've had in years. You asked for lower interest rates and Crossroads Ford delivered. Super low interest rates right now for up to 72 months. You gotta come see John and the gang. Check out all their brand new Fords in stock and ready to go home with you today. Crossroads Ford of Kernersville, right off of I-40 on Highway 66. They make it so easy.
Do you know the secret to losing up to 1 pound of fat every day? Hi, this is Dr. Darcy Ward, DC, with Winston Weight Loss, and I know the secret. Our unique weight loss program makes it easy to lose weight, get healthy, and get your energy back naturally, safely, and effectively. For your free consultation, go to winstonweightloss.com.
Folks, don't wait another day. Let's lose the weight together. Your first step is to get in touch with the folks at Winston Weight Loss. The number is 336-800-3841. That's 336-800-3841. Or check them out online at winstonweightloss.com. Discover how you too can lose up to a pound of fat every single day. I've lost more than 50 pounds. You can do it too.
With Winston Weight Loss, there's no counting points or calories, no exercising, no prepackaged meals, no drugs, no surgery, and no injections with the risk of serious side effects. Many patients lose 20 to 30 pounds in about a month or two. For your free consultation, go to winstonweightloss.com. That's winstonweightloss.com.
Results may vary.
The news in the world's greatest entertainer, the hardest working man in show business. Ladies and gentlemen, the star of the show.
Now back to The Drive with Josh Graham.
We've made it to a Friday drive. It is WSJS, News Talk Sports for the Triad. Also, Friday at the Masters. We have updates throughout the show. However, far away from Augusta, but very close to us, there's a lot happening in college basketball right now. Earlier today, both Kyle Filipowski and Jared McCain announced they have declared for the NBA draft. That much was expected. Last night, Duke learning Tyrese Proctor was going to return, not as expected. And that decision is a massive, massive win for the Blue Devils. With respect to Jeremy Roach, they'd much rather have Proctor back than Jeremy. Some scouts told me at games throughout the year, Tyrese Proctor has the highest ceiling in the NBA than anybody on this Duke team. Higher than Flip, higher than McCain. You look at his build, he already has an NBA frame. He could still add some weight on that, on top of that frame, and we might see that in his third season with the Blue Devils. A terrific defender already. He might go into next year the best perimeter defender in the ACC. He's had games where he's exploded offensively. It just hasn't been that consistent, but you can see certainly him being that type of guy at Duke, and if he does that, then he's going to be a high draft pick in the NBA. Proctor's decision to return, it lessens the chances of Roach's return. He's probably looking around. If Caleb Foster's coming back and he's expected to come back, and you've also got Proctor there, do we know if Roach is going to start for Duke next year? And he's already done so much with Duke. Won an ACC championship, took him to a Final Four, 2 years of Coach K, two years of John Shire. He doesn't have much else to achieve, so it might just be best for everybody that he moves on, this being a bad draft. See if you can make it onto an NBA roster. Duke needs the roster space. John Shire, he's having difficult conversations with players, which might be why Mark Mitchell decided to enter the portal this week. Hey, Mark, we got Cooper Flagg and Malawak coming in, who are both top five picks, and they both play in the front court. Yeah, we're going to need this office. We're going to need this starting spot. Yeah. What would you say you do here, Christian Reeves? Jaden Shute. Christian Reeves already in the portal. Shute, not yet, but I imagine he'll probably get there. We learned of Filipowski entering the portal, or not entering the portal, declaring for the draft today. Jared McCain the same way. McCain actually had some kind words, some meaningful words he wanted to express on his social media today. Here's what he said.
Even only being here for 1 year, I got to see the impact and the power of the brotherhood, and that's what made this decision extremely hard. But I've always been a dream chaser. I've always been wanting to reach my goals, and that next one is the NBA. So with that being said, I will be entering my name in the 2024 NBA draft. I'm blessed and honored to be a part of the brotherhood, and I will be a Blue Devil for life.
Duke only has 13 scholarships. You might know of the top two recruits that I just mentioned that Duke's bringing in. You might even know about Isaiah Evans, who's from Charlotte, that's going to be a Blue Devil as well, a top 15 recruit. But did you know they also have three more on top of that? Six freshmen in this signing class. 13 scholarships, that's all you get. So you have the six freshmen, plus Proctor, plus Foster likely, plus Sean Stewart. And then you have Shute, who hasn't transferred out, Roach, who hasn't made a decision, TJ Power, and Jalen Blakes. When you add that together, that's 13 scholarships, which doesn't give John Shire any flexibility right now. A chance to add anybody in the portal. Do you know how many players Duke added in the portal last season? Zero. That's the number. They've tried, but they didn't add anybody, and they don't have anybody. They don't have any space right now to add a player in the moment. That should change as a result of some of these conversations, because this team could use a big-time transfer. It's been a long time since Duke has found a bona fide stud in the portal. Found somebody to transfer in and be a guy, a real dude for the Blue Devils. With respect to Theo John, Ryan Young, Jacob Grandison, that's not the caliber of player I'm talking about. I'm talking about a guy who's coming in and you know he's going to start and he's going to be an impact player for Duke right away. They haven't had that since Rodney Hood on that Jabari Parker team when he transferred from Mississippi State a decade ago. Certainly a lot's happened in the last 10 years. I think Rodney Hood had to sit out a year in order to play at Duke. But putting that aside, if there's a starting spot available on this Duke team, that might be the most coveted destination of any across college basketball in this portal. Think about it. There are more than 1,000 players in the portal. John Shire can look at that entire portal and pick anybody and say, you. And he's not going to get turned down, because there are going to be at least 6-7 NBA scouts at every single Duke game next year. The hype's going to be crazy with Cooper Flagg and Malawak on the team. Some Brendan Marks was just with us saying that they're going to be more scouts at Duke games this next year than there were for Reddish, Zion, and RJ Barrett 5 years ago. Which player doesn't want to be in front of scouts that often and play for a potential number one team in the preseason and play Cameron and get NIL money, which we know Duke has? So when you look at the portal and you look at all those lists of guys who are in there, the top players, John Shire has his pick of the litter. If he wants John L. Davis from Florida Atlantic, assuming that credits can transfer and academics can get figured out, why not? If you want this small forward that you think might be more of a fit in your starting five from Wisconsin, talking about AJ Storr, you can have him. Just as long as you create one more roster spot, whether that be Jaden Chu or Jeremy Roach or both, if you want to add more guys in the portal. I think that's how Duke goes from where they're at right now to another level in being that number one team in the preseason. Tyrese Proctor's return, though, a massive, massive win for Duke. On X at WSGS Radio, if you want in, that's where we're streaming video in addition to YouTube and Twitch. Will Dalton is the executive producer of this show, facilitating it all, taking your calls, 336-777-1600. Getting to today's Masters action, though.
Yes, let's get to the Masters action today.
I was literally in the process of getting to it, but...
Well, that's what I'm here for.
All right, what do we got?
So currently, tie ball game...
Ball game? What sport are we talking about?
Bryson DeChambeau, Scottie Scheffler, whose wife has not gone into labor yet, still sitting at 7-under. DeChambeau's through 16, Scheffler through 10.
If she did go into labor, how would he know that no one has phones on the course?
Even his caddy?
It's a great question.
There you go.
I think also, caddies probably do have their phones.
Plenty of good action out there today, including Zach Johnson telling fans to bleep off after he hit a putt on 12 for double bogey.
How did we learn about that one?
Because you can hear it on TV when...
Oh.
Yeah.
That's
they
how you
they
get
started
got.
Clapping for him when he hit it, and he told him to bleep off. Lovely.
Thank you for that.
You're welcome.
Even though Tiger Woods' chances of winning a green jacket are slim, he's already won because he finished his round at plus one. The cut line's projected to be at 4-over. Tiger Woods has made it to the weekend. That's a win because that's the record for the most consecutive Masters cuts made at 24 in a row. That's a record that's not going to be broken. It's an impressive mark. And his career is going to be defined by consistency. The craziest record he has is 142 consecutive cuts made on the PGA Tour. To put that in perspective, that is 7 straight years of not having a bad weekend in which you missed the cut. 7 straight years. 142 cuts. To put that in perspective as well, that's 30 better than the next closest historically. The top consecutive cuts made streak on tour right now is Xander Schauffele, who's in the 30s. About more than 100 away from Tiger's record. But to get there today, he had to play 24 holes of golf, had to finish up his first round, and then play his entire second round. And that might not sound like a huge challenge to you. Oh, boo-hoo, you play golf. They don't get a cart like you do. And Tiger Woods had the car accident a few years ago, and Augusta is a hilly course. Shot a decent score. It wasn't like it was drama whether or not he was going to make the cut, but it is an achievement. Considering prior to today, he had played 24 holes of golf all year long. Now it's time to wonder, and it's not too early, whether or not Tiger Woods is going to play at Pinehurst at the U.S. Open. We're 2 months away from that. That course, not as physically demanding as Augusta is. He's not going to win a green jacket, and that's fine. It was a win just to see Tiger get to the weekend. And I hope that we get to see him play in the great state of North Carolina one more time, with the U.S. Open being at Pinehurst in a couple of months. It's not as physically taxing as Augusta is, and 2 months away, It's not too early to wish and to hope that that's the case. WD won't give me anything else other than Skips or Plays with Hayes today is Masters themed.
That's right.
I'm worried about this. I don't know what direction he's taking it. We'll find out together when Hayes Permar joins us next on The Drive.
From the Augusta National Golf Club, Westwood One Sports presents this special report on the Masters. I'm Ted Emmerich. It's starting to feel like a U.S. Open at Augusta. The greens have dried out. The winds are swirling. Not many low scores out there in the second round. Ludvig Åberg firing the round of the day so far, a 3-under 69. Åberg, the highly touted 24-year-old from Sweden. He played his college golf at Texas Tech. This is his first major start.
It was not easy, but I felt like I played pretty good. I especially read the greens very well and hit the putts the way I wanted to. And I think to get a score in today, I felt like that's probably what you almost have to do.
Åberg 2-under overall, 5 off the lead, and he's in the mix with the weekend approaching. Probably not the last time you'll say that about Åberg at a major championship. You're listening to coverage of the 2024 Masters on Westwood One.
Every business faces challenges, but complicated, expensive, and uncertain shipping shouldn't be one of them.
With USPS Ground Advantage from the United States Postal Service, you can avoid all the noise.
No more unexpected surcharges, hidden fees, or complex rate structures.
It's just easy, cost-effective, and dependable shipping. Tune your business's frequency to success and turn shipping to your advantage. Learn how at USPS.com/advantage. USPS Ground Advantage. Simple, affordable, reliable.
Now your ideas don't have to wait. Now they have everything they need to come to life. Dell Technologies and Intel are creating technology that loves ideas, loves expanding your business, evolving your passions. We push what technology can do, so great ideas can happen right now. Find out how to bring your ideas to life at Dell.com. Welcome to Now.
The wind is ruthless today at Augusta National, now 20 miles per hour from the west, gusts at 45 miles per hour. Let's check the leaderboard sponsored by USPS. Ground Advantage, simple, affordable, reliable. Bryson DeChambeau managing it. He's even today through 16, tied for the lead at 7-under par with Scottie Scheffler. Scheffler, the world number one, with a birdie at 10 to pull back into a tie for the lead. He dealt with bogeys at 5 and 7, his first bogeys of the week, but you just got to plow through that. He's birdied 2 of the last 3 as he heads to Amen Corner. Max Homa is 1 back at 6-under. Nikolai Højgaard from Denmark, 4-under in the clubhouse, like Homa. Projected cut at 5-over. Tiger Woods will make the cut at +1, 24th consecutive made cut for Tiger, a Masters record. Some of the notables who will miss the cut, Dustin Johnson, Jordan Spieth, British Open champion Brian Harman, Victor Hovland in danger at +6. He's 7-over today making the turn. From Augusta, I'm Ted Emmerich, Westwood One.
It's The Drive with Josh Graham, WSJS.
When Hayes Permar joins us, we'll play Skips or Plays with Hayes, where he will tell us whatever WD has cooked up, if it's good or not. This is all the information I've been given. It's Masters themed. And if you don't know the game by now, WD pulls 3 songs and Permar decides whether or not it's a skip or a play. And when he said Masters theme, all I could think is, what type of music is Masters theme? When I think of the Masters, I think of the music that you just heard there a second ago. Light and gentle and the jangly. Can piano be jangly? I know guitars could be jangly, but maybe it's a very light piano that's playing. It's very soft. Perfect for Jim Nantz to whisper over, and, you know, we all know the theme music. But what other music would you classify as being Masters theme? Are we just going to hear the welcome music that we get when they're going over highlights on CBS? right, what type of music could even qualify? Then I start thinking of golf music, and that's not a lot better. It's not a lot of different categories that brings up. Are we just going to do the Caddyshack soundtrack, and we have what Rodney, the Journey song that Rodney Dangerfield is dancing to? Literally, this has been driving me crazy today because WD pulls together this list, and I don't have any more information other than that. So when Hayes Permar drops by, we'll play Skips or Plays with Hayes. Getting to the latest on the leaderboard, you heard the update a second ago on our Masters update presented by Westwood One. It's still Bryson DeChambeau and Scottie Scheffler at the top. Both are at 7 under par. Max Homa at 6 under after that. It does feel like Scheffler's tournament to win. When you go in and you're only a plus 450 favorite, when that's as small as the odds are, the book's telling you they really like Scheffler. Because normally, favorites aren't sitting with those type of odds up front. And then you've got Beefy Bryson there, who's not the most trustworthy in majors. We learned at the U.S. Open a few years ago. Max Homa's never won before. But if you were to put together the list of players that you want to root for to win a major, Max Homa's on the list. Now, is he top 10 on the world golf ranking? I don't know. I don't know how much stock you put into it. I put a lot of stock into it. It's part of the reason why I picked Xander Schauffele, 5th in the world, as my winner this year in the Masters. But Max Homa's just outside the top 10. He's 11th. So when you start devising that list of, okay, you haven't won a major championship, who do you want to see on that list? Because the Masters, 7 of the last 9 winners of a green jacket had not won a Masters or won a major championship prior to doing so. I think the list goes Xander Schauffele, who's probably the most due, Max Homa, and after that, Ricky Fowler probably, just because how long Ricky Fowler's been around. Even though Ricky hasn't been as much of a contender, he's not knocking on the door in any type of way. I'd probably have to scroll a great way before finding him on the world golf ranking at all. Certainly not in the top 25. He's not in the top 30. This is a fun game we call Josh Graham Scrolls until he finds Ricky Fowler's name on the world golf ranking. Not in the top 50, 75. He's a considerable way down. So among those who are top of the sport, who are knocking on the door, having an opportunity to win, Edberg, the Swede, seems to be the guy that many in golf love and feel like could have a shot at winning this week. Those are the ones that I have circled. Obviously, Scheffler's the obvious one. But the ones I have circled after that, Max Homa and looking at those young guys to get an opportunity. Max Homa always has a big smile on his face everywhere he goes. He has that weird tick. I don't know if I like it or not, but how could you not? Jared McCain has this tick too, who just declared for the NBA draft today, that regardless of what's happening, he always has a big smile on his face when he's answering questions. It could be a negative question that you're asking. Hey, why did you miss that shot from 3 in the second half with 10 minutes to go? And he'll have a big smile on his face as he answers it. Hayes Permar now joining us. Sports Channel 8. I have a very Sports Channel 8 question I want to throw at you.
All right.
Masters, overrated, underrated, properly rated?
I think the Masters is rightly rated. It was maybe a little bit cooler when a little fewer people cared about it. And I'll give a perfect example. I think Masters gear has kind of jumped the shark. Like, wearing Masters gear used to be cool. Maybe it was just I was younger, but I feel like a few years ago, because you truly had to either have gone to the Masters or know somebody who did. So now I'm an old man, and I'm on these old man Facebook. I call them like swap meets, but it'll be like the inner Raleigh Facebook trade site or whatever. And like most, it's like people yelling, selling their little girl clothes. Sorry, my dog wants attention here, so she's squeaking things. So like it's like people selling little kids' clothes or like, oh, I got this nice dress from Anthropologie and I only wore it once and now I sell for $100. Well, these people are like coming back from Augusta with like three different hats, whatever, and just like selling it. And I'm like, who goes to Augusta? I don't even know if they're selling it for like an upcharge or if they think they're just being a nice person to like get gear to other people. But I'm like, part of getting the gear is like the memory of like, oh, I went to that practice round and like, oh, I bought this Masters hat off of Facebook. Like that makes it way less cool. So I do think, as much as I like the fact that the Masters has opened up this lottery that didn't exist for most of my lifetime, I mean, I went the old fashioned way. I knew rich people and they invited me to go, right? I've never won the lottery. So now that it's like opened up to the masses, I get it. I like it, but it maybe feels like it's a little bit like watered down. Like the cool bar or restaurant that you always knew was super cool and, you know, always amazing. And now everybody goes there. That just makes it a little less cool. It's still very cool. That's the reason everybody goes, but it just feels a little less cool than when you first went there.
So you're saying that John Dell, us asking John Dell to get us a hat or a shirt, makes us less cool.
Slightly different. Knowing a specific person and asking them because you know they're going to get you a specific item, still kind of cool. Because you still like know somebody who's going. I mean, yours like that's like a dorky media connection, so less cool. But still fairly cool. Yeah.
I am so curious because I've been wondering this for a while. What angle WD is going to take a Masters theme skips or plays, but he says he feels really good about it. I don't know how you do a Masters theme skips or plays, but we're going to find out right now.
Hayes Permar is somewhat of a Renaissance man, an expert in the finer things, but he hangs his hat on music.
Loves his God, and he's no friend of Satan.
He was like, oh, six, getting busy with the sticks, been watching Big Mike and Lil Trick.
I just need a Zion and someone he can dunk on.
Today, Hayes will decide if this music is smash or trash, glows or blows. It's time for Skips or Plays with Hayes.
R.I.P. Smash Mouth, welcome in OJ to heaven. You're a real one.
Oh, God. Where's the Gary Hahn drop?
Real quick, another example. Do you remember what the weekday Masters broadcast used to be on, the Thursday, Friday?
No.
It used to be on the USA Network.
Oh, that's right.
Can you imagine that now? But, like, that was kind of, like, the geeky part about it. Like, real hardcore, like, golf heads thought the Masters was cool were watching the USA Network. Not, like, Scott Van Pelt with Curtis Strange. I mean, it's mostly the CBS guys. They just put them in USA flag, you know, mic flags for the days, but just stuff like that where it was like, you really, it felt something like cool. Like oh, I'm going to be watching golf on the USA Network. I don't know. Little things like that. Sorry.
R.I.P. Smash Mouth. Where's the Gary Hahn drop to get us out of OJ?
Let's go to the sidelines. Tony Haynes.
Shout out to Gary in retirement now. He's finally retired. What is the theme? Like it's Masters theme, but what do you mean?
So what we're going to do is like the Masters theme itself is primarily piano.
Oh, it's right? The, yeah, like the gentle piano. Yeah, of course.
So what we're going to do is we're going to have songs that have piano fairly heavily featured in them with
I like
riffs
it.
And things.
I so, like it. I used to play the piano a little bit. I know same. Permar does. Let's see what you've come up with. What's the first song?
We're going to start out with some Billy Joel with Scenes from an Italian Restaurant.
Things are okay with me these days. Got a good job. I got a good office. I got a new wife.
All right, this is a play, but didn't you just start the song like right before the like long piano instrumental? I thought we were going to hear the or I guess that's the next one coming up. But there's like this one has piano interludes that make it like good. But yeah, this is a play.
That might be my favorite Joel song.
Hey, Spermar.
There's the dog.
Now
what's his name? You have massive dogs.
This is Penelope.
Hey, Penelope.
Hey.
What's going on? Also, did you know there's words to the Masters theme? Have you ever looked at the words?
No, are they?
Look, I mean, it's like, I don't know how the tune goes, but it's like, it's springtime in Augusta. The flowers are in bloom. I mean, it's something like that. It's like,
I'm going to find those right now as WD gives us another song.
Yes. So now we're going to do 1,000 Miles by Vanessa Carlton.
If I could fall into the sky, do you think time would pass me by? Because you know
Puppy's I'd loving it.
Walk 1,000 miles if I could just see you.
Gotta let it go, let it go.
Tonight.
Is it the music video, her riding around town in a piano? Like on a piano?
I think so, yeah.
Have you seen White Chicks?
No.
There was at Camp Seagull, we were counselors. We used to do letter writing on Friday nights, which was A, it was a time you had to write like 12 letters in a row home to parents. But also, you got some time away from your cabin because you're working on it. You'd just be chilling out. You'd be sitting there, and everybody would be listening to their own music. And one time there was a guy, I think maybe he knew he was doing it, but he was singing out loud. And it was to this song, so nobody could hear the song, just hear him. And by the end, he was just in full, like, playing the whole thing. And that became, like, one of the indelible moments of this song for me.
Is that a play?
It's a play. It's a play.
Close us out strong, WD. It's a pretty good list.
I got a prediction. I'm predicting Walking in Memphis.
Good guess. That's Mark Combe. What do you have?
We're going to do a song by Bruce Hornsby that Tupac did a far superior version of The Way It Is.
Whoa! This better than Changes?
Yes.
Oh, I thought you said it wasn't better than Changes.
No, it is. Oh, no, Changes is better.
Debatable. Z can't buy a job. There's a good bluegrass version of this song with Bruce Hornsby playing with Ricky Skaggs.
Great. I heard that live at Merlefest, which is in a few weeks. Outstanding. I assume it's a play in your book.
It is a play. The other thing is, I happen to know the person who was Bruce Hornsby's manager when the offer from Tupac came. And you have two options. You can ask for just like a one-time right to use this song fee, or you can ask to be a co-writer and get a percentage of the song. And
you want points.
The one-time fee, this guy was like, it was the most substantial offer I had ever seen. I was basically telling Bruce Hornsby, do not take this $1 million offer. I think this is going to be a banger, and I think you're going to want co-writing credits. And, you know, like, he could have gotten $1 million, and if the song goes nowhere, he still gets his million. Instead, he's got a co-writing credit, and he got whatever percentage of whatever it made, and it was worth a lot more. But at the time, it was like telling somebody, no, do not take the sure $1 million. This song's going to be a banger. Count on it. Let's get the co-writing credit.
Wasn't Bruce Hornsby a hooper?
He is, and his son played, Nick Hornsby, played at UNC Asheville. But huh. Bruce Hornsby and Roy Williams, I think, are boys. They would go to Hornets games together. But he's a big basketball fan. Love me some Bruce Hornsby.
There you go.
With or without the range.
3 for 3 on plays, WD.
I mean, I'm a sucker for a piano. I'm surprised we didn't hear any Ben Folds, but that's okay.
All right, I got this for you, Hayes and WD. Can you give me the Masters music again? Can we cue that up? Because I've got the lyrics in front of me here.
There's definitely something about springtime in Augusta. I know that's like...
Well, it's springtime in the valley on Magnolia Lane. It's the Augusta National and the master of the game who wear that green coat on Sunday afternoon. Look at the 18th fairway. Singing this tune.
I don't la, 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 la. Well done. I was trying to do your backup there.
Thank you. There you go. There's some.
Well done.
Hayes.
How have you not applied for a credential at Augusta yet?
On that note, we just got our credential request back for the U.S. Open. We'll be doing our show there from Pinehurst. And I imagine if Tiger is playing the U.S. Open or playing Augusta, Pinehurst is not as hilly as Augusta is. So this might be the last time we see Tiger in the state of North Carolina if he plays the U.S. Open.
Could be. Did you guys need an engineer down there?
Working on it. You'll figure out your way to get in there, I'm sure.
We'll see.
Got to figure
it
out.
It always is. It's always the hottest week of the year. Whenever we host the U.S. Open, you know it's going to be a scorcher.
Do you have a rooting interest in Augusta this weekend?
I mean, I would have loved it if, like, Grayson Murray had all the makings of, like, a dude who would come out and shoot, like, a first-round 62 and then, like, blow up and shoot a 78 the next day. So that would have been fun. I do kind of like seeing what Akshay Bhatia is doing, another local guy. Those are, like, with no Webb Simpson to pull for. Those are my two guys.
I'm rooting for Scottie Scheffler to be, like, in a massive lead on Sunday and then his wife go into labor and he leaves just to see all the mad people betting. Because he said he's going to leave if that happens.
He said it. I don't believe it. I don't believe it.
He won 2 years ago. I honestly believe it's true. I do.
It's the right thing to say. So you go ahead and you say it, and then you hope you don't get caught on your bluff. And if you do, then you're like, I was just saying that to be a good husband. I'm not doing that. To be honest, I mean, look, I don't have a kid, so I don't know. And my wife crushes me on this, and she would continue. I'm like, I'm going to be there for the kid's whole life. I'm not a like, I got to be there for the birth guy. Like, what's special about the birth?
A lot of hot takes by Permar today.
I feel like it's arrogant to think that your kid being born is something special. Like, be there minute.
Are you a big celebrate birthdays guy too? Like, you could say, oh, I'm there all 364 of the other days. Why are we celebrating this one?
Nah, I mean, you got to be there for you. I'll celebrate my kid's birthday more than I celebrate my birthday ever.
I'm not going to be at my kid's birthday. Why? I'm there the other 364 days.
Well, I do feel a little bit of that. Anybody who places too much emphasis on, like, this single moment or, like, you have to do this, that's just never been my bag. Like, things, people that are like when people pass away, I never hold myself to every year at this time I'll do this, or every time I watch the Masters, I'll do a nod to this person, you know, partly because you like, then time moves on. Life happens. If you forget one of those things and you're like, oh my God, that means I don't care about that person. Like, that's not the case at all. So
let's go to the sidelines, Tony Haynes.
If you make moments too sacred, then the only thing that could happen is, like, ruining them. Right. So, like, yeah, awesome. By all means, you should be in the delivery room if it makes sense. Right. But it's not one of those things where it's like, hey man, this is one of the biggest things of your life. You're this unborn child, or this about to be born child, if given the option at age 21, would probably be like, dad, go win the Masters. Like, let's catch up later. Like, I don't know. I think people put too much emphasis on what is supposed to be the right thing to say or do. It's like watching the Army-Navy game. Sounds cool to do, not actually that cool. Watching your kid be born, whatever. Give me the rest of the life.
I do like the idea of the Gary Hahn drop being like a play them off music, because we're running out of time. That'd be great just to have to cut off a long-winded Hayes.
Yeah, I think you got to leave it for the awkward transition.
That's fine. Hayes, it's good to see you. We'll talk next week.
Good to see you guys.
What do we got in Take It to the House?
This man felt like he had a right to be sitting where he was sitting.
Next.
Listen to us online at the new WSJS.com. Listen to us on your smartphone at WSJS.com. Listen to us wherever and whenever you want at WSJS.com. Like when your boss is complaining you don't pay attention.
These reports are all wrong. Why can't you pay attention?
What does he know? Come hang out with us at WSJS.com, your online home for news, talk, and sports. WSJS.com.
Close your eyes and imagine you're surrounded by thousands of passionate fans, energy rushing through your veins, and you're cheering on Carolina Core FC, your new men's professional soccer team. Carolina Core FC is the Triad team, the Triad's party. They are part of the MLS Next Pro Soccer League, and Truist Point will be the home pitch. Learn more and get tickets at CarolinaCoreFC.com. That's CarolinaCoreFC.com. Let's get this party started!
Why is your garage door making a loud noise? Precision Garage Door can tell you. Your garage door could have worn rollers, poor lubrication, or other issues. Luckily, not every noise from your garage door is the sign of something serious. Let an expert take a look. It is important to address any unusual noises as quickly as possible to keep your garage door in top working condition and your family safe. Precision Garage Door offers free service calls with any type of repair. So relax and make life easier. Visit PrecisionDoorNC.com today. That's PrecisionDoorNC.com.
Kick off your weekend the Charlotte FC way when the party returns to Bank of America Stadium on Saturday, April 13th.
They deflect to Westwood. Half ball, he should be scored! The captain puts it home!
Don't miss the action when the Crown battles Toronto FC for a Saturday night showdown in the Queen City. Arrive early and score a replica Sir Minty Cape at the gates presented by Ticketmaster. Get your tickets today by visiting charlottefootballclub.com/tickets.
We're for Washington. We love Febreze's new scent.
Refresh and energize.
So much we made a song about it.
I can't escape this feeling inside. Refresh and energize. It's a more. It's a vibe, breathing for the first time. Soul free, soul alive. Breathe happy for breathe. Smells like paradise. Breathe happy for breathe.
Instead of just talking, why don't you listen? That's why you have people call in. Listen for a minute.
Oh, welcome back to the Happy Circle.
The Drive with Josh Graham.
I want to use the setup to Rhinestone Cowboy to welcome a new sponsor of the show, Ace Hardware. WD, you want to sing the jingle like you've been wanting to sing?
Ace is the place with the help for hardware, folks.
Spring's here, so head to your local neighborhood Ace on Stratford Road. They know your backyard's their backyard, so go see Josh and his team, like his name, for help with anything from picking out your next grill, getting your grass to look its best, or even having azaleas bloom at just the right time. And we know it's the right time for azaleas. Also, shout out to our friends at Crossroads Ford of
Kernersville.
They have those large spring rebates. Take advantage of them. Crossroads Ford, Kernersville.com, right off of I-40 on Highway 66. See John and the gang there. All right, before we take it to the house real quick.
Like a rhinestone cowboy. Riding out on a horse at a star-spangled rodeo. Like a rhinestone cowboy. Getting cards and letters from people I don't even know. And offers coming over the phone.
Real quickly, let's take it to the house.
Past the 15, past the 10, past the 5 for the drive. We'll take it to the house.
1, 2, 3.
Brought to you by Tar Heel Basement Systems. What do you have?
You know, in many places, a drunk man sitting in the garbage can just chilling on the sidewalk, that might be an unusual thing.
Sure.
Not in thought of. Vladimir. So this man told St. Petersburg police when he was approached that, quote, he was allowed to be drunk and disorderly and sit naked in a trash can on the public sidewalk, close quote. That's what he says. He was intoxicated, unsteady on his feet, smelled like alcohol, according to the officers, when they removed him from the garbage can. Then he was arrested for that. Apparently, he resisted one of the officers nonviolently. Got fined $520 for trying to sit in the trash can drunk.
Can't do that.
No.
You know, I appreciate the creativity. It's just not going to work out that way. Mm-mm. Rory McIlroy has fallen off the wagon, boys and girls. Who could have saw that coming at the Masters? We'll have a new Masters champion that we'll be sure to talk about on a Monday drive.
From the Augusta.